the most beautiful thing in the world.
Let me ask you guys a hypothetical question.
Uh-huh.
Who do you think the biggest bitch is?
You talking about the biggest little bitch?
The biggest little bitch.
Yeah.
If I had to throw out a name, I'm not gonna, you know what? Off the top of my head, I'm going to go Will Wheaton.
That's a good one. If I had to throw out a name to go up against Will Wheaton, I would probably say Chris Kattan.
Damn. Ooh.
Vanilla, no!
Yeah, I mean, he is a good
no!
one.
Vanilla!
What about that little bitch, Carlos Mencia? What about him?
Oh, dude, Carlos he's an Mencilia? Ultimate little bitch.
He is a little bitch.
You know what, dude? I wonder.
If only there was some way to decide. Like, you know, some kind of fucking...
Maybe if they competed.
Bitch off. Ah, yeah, motherfucker.
Measured in Biebers.
Measured in Biebers. You know it.
Put on the God voice.
Oh, baby, baby, baby. Oh.
This is the battle for the biggest little bitch of all time.
The biggest Chris little Kattan, bitch that you ever seen.
Carlos Mencia. Will Wheaton, measured Will in Biebers. Wheaton. This is Will the shit. Wheaton. This is it, man.
Oh, yeah.
Hey, what was that last boy. Little drop you used, TJ? I think we'll be hearing a lot of those in the next couple of hours, gentlemen, because we have a Herculean task ahead of us.
Herculean task!
There are three little bitches in front of us push the fucking limits of believability and push the very definition of what it means to be a little bitch.
Oh, yeah, dude. Faux show, faux show, faux show.
There's some fierce competition. Chris Kattan, Carlos Mencia.
Or Carlos Menstelia, like I like to
Wesley.
Call him.
Or Wesley. Can we just go ahead and replace Will Wheaton with Wesley? Wesley.
Yeah. I mean, we should just be calling him Wesley.
Wesley.
Oh, you look fabulous.
Oh, my God. Look at him.
It's Chris Kattan.
He's still doing the 90s comedian wacky thing. Like, look at this outfit.
You guys want some cooking? I'm Chris Kattan, everybody. Chris Kattan. It's me, everyone. Chris Kattan.
I'm the one that they always call when they need a gay character played, but I'm not gay at all. I'm Chris Kattan.
All right. So, you know, we could do this a couple ways. Normally, we kind of go by category, but I was thinking we could just look at each of these motherfuckers separately. But if you guys prefer the traditional route, we could do that too.
I mean, we need to use the categories, right?
Oh yeah. Well, I meant like appraising them each one at a time.
Oh sure, yeah.
Across the spectrum,
I'm fine with that.
Categories.
We can switch it up and see how that works.
It's just a little easier with the way that we each chose a person to do research. So. And,
oh shit! You know what? If we're gonna do Kattan first, once I need to go grab my phone because I have to be able to read along with my research. So
okay. I will wait, and in the meantime, I'll make fun of Chris Kattan.
Hey, everybody, I'm Chris Kattan. Look at me with this hot model who's a head taller than me. Look at me. I'm booby height because I love boobies as heterosexual Chris Kattan.
What do you think, Scotty? Let's TJ, hear your Chris Kattan voice.
TJ, I will not do that because I find this to be extremely offensive.
You find it to be offensive?
It's extremely offensive.
Whoa.
TJ, I would ask you now stop attacking.
Hey, yeah, what's up?
The homosexual community,
what did
TJ.
What did Chris Kattan say when he met Vanilla Ice again?
Vanilla! No! Vanilla! No! Vanilla! Vanilla!
Vanilla, please! Dude, TJ's got the best Chris Kattan out of all of us. Dude, you're so dead on Chris Kattan right now. You sound just like this whiny... like, unsufferable, undefensible fucking piece of garbage that we're about to talk about.
Oh, my God.
I gotta tell you guys.
Chris Kattan is next level has been, too.
Let me tell you this, dude. Of all the bullshit that I had to wade through for this show, I did most of the pulling for ICP, right?
Yep.
Which is, you know, whatever. I kind of like them, but I kind of don't like them.
Right.
And there was a lot of bullshit that I had to dig through to find those things. But this was the hardest. And this was really, like, the lightest job I had, honestly. Because it was like, you know, it's one of three, right? So it's not a full show. I just got to pull one third of a show. And it's Chris Kattan, so there's a lot of shit out there about... This was like I swear to God, man, this was the last thing I finished. It was like bamboo under my fingernails. It was like pulling teeth to even keep me like going, because I just see everything I found just amplified his bitchlitude.
Dude, so that's exactly how I felt about Will Wheaton.
Well, definitely it picked
was the
a good
last
opponent.
Thing I did. I dreaded it. I was like, yeah, oh, I put my it off. God.
Well, let me tell you about Carlos Mencia. He was tough because like in most of these categories, there's just almost nothing. Like, he has almost no sort of film roles to speak of, almost no television appearances other than him just doing comedy on, a variety show here and there.
Or his show, yeah.
Or his show Mind of Mencia, which is, like, the copyright on that is, like, super fucking protected for some goddamn reason.
All right. Well, I've got my notes in front of me. I'm ready to start this roasting of Chris Kattan. I mean, I don't even know if you can call this a roasting. It's like a eulogy before he's dead, basically.
Ooh, a spit roast! Yeah!
Put it in my butt first.
Stuff it in my butt and then stick it in my mouth. But don't stick it in my mouth too soon because I want to be able to go, oh, Chris Kattan!
Oh, my God. Please die.
He's so fucking awful, man. All right, I gotta get through this. Kattan was born in Culver City, California. His father, Kip King, was an actor and most notably a voice actor. King was probably best known for voicing Taylor Smurf.
I have a clip.
Yep. So I have if you want to hear Chris Kattan's dad,
let's listen to Chris Kattan's dad doing his very best Papa Smurf impression. Well, it's not Papa Smurf. He was Taylor Smurf, you said?
Taylor Smurf, yeah.
All right. So this is Chris Kattan's daddy doing this. Where the fuck did it go? I know it's in here somewhere. Son of a bitch. Do-do-do-do-do-do. Where the fuck is it? Hold on. I'll fucking find it. I know it's in here. I think it's got to be in here somewhere.
I think I might have found it.
What?
Scotty found the clip.
Yeah, there it is.
Yeah, there you go.
Here it is. All right, so I don't know why it wasn't in there, but here it is now.
So, the whole day long, Smurfy stitches straight and strong. Suits for all my friends to wear, sewn with tender Smurfing care.
You can kind of hear it.
The more I sew, Smurfy outfits row on row. There are many Smurfs you
see. Well, do you keep fucking threading the same fucking hole?
Oh. Oh, I'll never finish in time for the fashion show.
The fashion show? All the Smurfs wear the same fucking pair of pants and hat. Except for Papa Smurf.
Get the advice you want, Taylor. Look no further than yours truly, Brainy Smurf. You? What do you know about fashion? Are you kidding?
Has this guy heard of fucking Bangladesh or China or some shit? Just outsource your shit.
Yeah, he needs to outsource to, like, Smurf Bekistan or some shit.
I mean, they're all wearing the same shit. They're part of a cult, basically. So just fucking outsource this shit.
Yeah, the Smurfs are, like, a pretty creepy cult society, so.
A simple spell properly cast.
A simple spell?
Let's see.
You don't even need to go that fucking far. Bangladesh. Third world country, Vietnam, sweatshops.
Yeah, the Smurfs need to learn to exploit third world labor like we have.
Trust me, Taylor. Trust me.
Don't trust Brainy Smurf, dude. Intellectuals are the first ones to go in a communist society like Smurfville Village.
So anyway, that's Kip King.
Yeah, you can hear him. You can hear the Chris Kattan in there.
But let's be honest, Taylor Smurf was probably the lamest of the Smurfs. I mean, who likes Taylor Smurf?
All the Smurfs pretty fucking lame.
But whatever. He was also the gay Smurf, which is interesting, because I guess Kip King got typecast as a gay guy as well. But whatever. He was also in a bunch of other stuff.
Little Rascals.
Yeah, yeah. Shecky and the Biscuits. He was in Little Rascals. Scooby-Doo and Scrappy-Doo. Tom and Jerry Kids. Droopy.
Let me at him.
Flintstones TV specials. I mean, he was whatever. He's a successful dude. He had a good career.
A yabba dabba doo in 1993.
His mother, who was kind of a mysterious figure, I found it really hard to find pictures of her at all. In fact, I only found one. Her name is Hajnalka E. Biro, which She was once photographed for Playboy. I could find hide nor hair of those photos, but Wikipedia says that's real and provided evidence for it, just not actual pictures. And worked as a model for a while in London, so kind of a hottie.
It's kind of weird that you can't find pictures of someone who was a model who posed for Playboy.
I mean, dude, if you can find her, then I'll stand corrected.
No, I'm not. I'm not saying that.
It's, I mean, maybe she wasn't like a. Maybe she was just a swimsuit person. Like, maybe she didn't get all full naked. It didn't say she was fully nude. It just said she posed for Playboy. I mean, that, I think that implies nude, but whatever. So his mother was, you know, kind of good looking. I mean, I think there's a picture of her if you want to pull it up with a very young Chris Kattan. Also, the youngest picture I could find of Chris Kattan. So this is Hajnalka E. Biro, the woman that spawned the demon that is Chris Kattan. you can see here, damn. The maternal instinct is very strong. You know, most animals in the wild would have shunned something so hideous and left it to die and for the vultures to pick clean. But she,
I mean,
you know,
rightly so.
The maternal instinct was very strong in her, and she, for some reason, allowed the horrible eyesore that is Chris Kattan to
suckle her teeth. She allowed Taylor Smurf to fucking mount her, and then she gave birth to Vanilla!
No!
And then she decided to keep it for some unknown reason.
So
an act of mercy.
His mother and father didn't last long. Their marriage broke up, and he had a stepfather eventually. His mother's actually a native of Budapest, Hungary, and is a Buddhist. His stepfather was a Buddhist therapist and monk. His half-brother, Andrew Jocelyn, is a professional musician and composer. Kattan was raised on a Zen retreat on Mount San Antonio, or Mount Baldy, outside of L.A. He lived on Bainbridge Island, Washington, where he attended he went to high school in Washington. He lived on a Zen retreat for a while. I guess that's where he got pussified.
I don't know. It seems to me like he was born pussified.
Here's a common thread that runs through recent stuff we've covered on DFF. Kattan was a member of several improv comedy troupes, one of them being the Groundlings in L.A.
When did the Groundlings become a portal to madness, I don't
know.
Dude?
His dad was actually an original member of the Groundlings, so know how he got
nepotism.
In.
Oh, nepotism.
Yeah, a little bit of a, he is Taylor Smurf's kid, so I guess maybe we should give him a shot. So Kattan also did some minor roles on TV, and including the second episode of the second season of News Radio. No, this is not based on entirely Julie's life as a Photoshop employee. So he did a bit part as a Photoshop employee on some episode of some show nobody cares about anymore, and that was listed in his biography. So you can tell that Chris really doesn't get a whole lot of work, which, I got to be honest with you at this point, I think because I've been reading this, I've been really judicious and have not passed out any goddamn vanillas. Any goddamn Biebers. So what do you think Chris deserves for his early life here?
I don't know. I didn't put that as a category.
I mean, what is the first category? It's like, okay, bio, right?
The categories are...
It should be stand-up.
Yeah.
I think we agreed with Will Wheaton because he was not a comedian that he was going to do. We're going to do social media.
Right. Because, yeah, he's not really a stand up guy. All right. So we're just kind of digging in.
We haven't stand up, really TV work, films, crowning achievement.
Well,
where
TV work so far, he needs at least one Bieber, dude. His forgettable fucking.
So let's move on to his SNL characters, because that's really what Chris Kattan is known best for. Is for his stint on Saturday Night Live, which, you know, he was on for a while. So you got to give him that. But I pulled some pictures. You can't really use video of this because it's all highly, you know, Saturday Night Live and NBC or whatever the fuck, or just take your channel down if you try. But so I got some pictures of these characters. Yeah. And we can talk about what we remember about them.
All right, we could do that.
The first is Mango.
Oh, God, Mango.
So this Mango here standing next to
Garth
Brooks.
What I remember about
Mango
is Mango being more annoying than ever funny. Which pretty much is the trademark. That's the Chris Kattan trademark style, really.
Yeah, it's just really annoying and in your face.
So just like Mango is just like, I'm over the top gay, you know, and it's like, all
right. Right, cool, but it was always like, you know, played with a little shred of plausible deniability. So, you know, when something gay would actually happen, Mango would always be freaked out.
Yeah, like, oh, no, I'm not down
really
for that.
I'm not really gay, but I'm just kind of sort of
Mango
gay.
He was
kind of
the
gay.
First metrosexual.
It sucks. It was terrible. It was his shrill,
You can't have it, the mango. He talked in like this weird Spanish accent, kind of. And it was basically like he was just over the top, stereotypical gay dude.
Someone called him Pink Smegma.
You can tell, if you can zoom in a little bit, you can tell from the look on Garth Brooks' face how well this character went over and how funny it was to people. Why they kept it. Look at Garth here.
Hello, darkness, my old friend.
But Chris Kattan is proud as fuck to be standing there in gold sequin shorts.
I'm just going to look away and pretend this is not happening.
Yep, this is a low point of my career up till this point. Oh, well, Rope in the Wind was triple platinum, so whatever.
What you gonna do? So I'm going to give him another one for Mango.
Oh, yeah, he definitely, at least one.
Oh, dude, he's at least three.
For all right, fucking... I agree with Scotty. He needs more. So three beavers for Mango. I mean,
look at the shit. Look at the shit-eating look on his fucking face. The shit-eating fucking grin, dude.
I mean, he's just proud of it. Look at him.
Starting
no
to
shame.
Thunder outside.
Ooh, storm. Oh, dude, look at Garth Brooks is on the screen, dude. The Thunder Roll.
And the Thunder Roll.
Anyway, the next one.
What?
This is Mr. Peepers. I don't know if you even remember this one.
I do not.
This one was a brilliant performance by Chris Kattan. Actually, I'm just kidding. It's one of the most annoying things you've ever seen. Basically, the joke is he's a chimp, but he's even worse than a chimp because even chimps just chill out. So the whole gag with this, and it was a recurring thing on SNL, is Will Ferrell would play a scientist and who was trying to give a lecture about Mr. Peepers, who was this recently discovered chimp-man hybrid from some Madagascar island or whatever the fuck. You know what I mean? And Mr. Peepers makes horrible noises and stomps around and farts and rips up paper and drags his fingernails along the chalkboard behind the scientist that's trying to give a lecture. But the scientist doesn't seem to notice and keeps going. That's the gag. So basically, it was the perfect role for Chris Kattan because all he had to do was be Chris Kattan.
Be
the
annoying
most annoying,
shit.
Loud, overbearing presence in the room and be completely ignorant of anybody else. And it was perfect for him, and it sucked. Mr. Peepers is horrible. Give him at least three more Biebers for it unless you guys want to tack on a couple more.
He needs at least
I'm comfortable at seven. I mean, like, total now.
Yeah.
So yeah, three is fine. I don't know the character, but mm-hmm. from your description,
yeah,
it
I can't really
like
comment on the character, but the image is just it's frightening.
Yeah, this is a fucking
this is
Azrael Abyss.
Yeah. So there was a recurring skit on the old Saturday Night Live called Goth Talk, and it was like a public access show run by some goth kids, and he was one of those goth kids. I would hesitate. I would say that like out of all the roles he ever played, and I mean movies and everything, this is probably the one that fit him the best. I think it's the closest to who he really is, but it still sucks. It's annoying. It's shrill. The funniness of it wears off after the first, like, minute, but then you're left with, like, 16 of these skits. You know what I mean? His whole gimmick in this was, like, he talked in a really high-pitched voice, which is shocking for Chris
Kattan. Wow, really?
Really going outside of his comfort zone
and it
there.
Was very flat and emotionless, but he was always smiling through it. So he would be like, I'm Azrael Abyss. And my soul is as dark as midnight. You know what I mean? And it was kind of, you know, whatever. He looked like one of those crazy, cringy goth kids. So it was funny for about a minute.
It's almost just like his lame attempt at doing the whole Wayne's World thing. But like, I will do it for the goth generation, you know? Because it was like a public access show.
Yeah. So, it sucked. It might have been his best character on Saturday Night Live, honestly. But it still sucked.
But it's not really saying
so
much.
How many more for that? Two?
At least two for me. I'm fine with two.
Two more for him.
Damn. Scotty wants to assess two more, and I'm not going to fight him on it because I mean, this is just sad. And it gets worse, guys.
I mean, this being his best SNL role, that's pretty sad.
So the next role we'll talk about is Gay Hitler.
Gitler.
This one, totally out of character for a Chris Kattan role, by the way. Somebody that's flamboyantly... So this the gimmick is, I bet you can guess...
He's Hitler, but gay.
Yep. There it is.
All right. I'll give it two more points.
Jimmy Fallon's in the background, so I'd add an extra one.
Yeah.
Fair enough.
Yeah. I agree.
You have one to add anymore, Paul?
Nope. I think that's fair.
We're up to 12 Biebers now.
Oh, man.
For TV
we're not,
work.
We've only just begun.
That's for TV work alone.
But we're almost to the end of his... Saturday Night Live. This is Doug Butabi, one half of the Butabi brothers, which we'll talk about a little more in depth later. But these guys were like immigrant brothers
that went to clubs all the time and didn't really realize that they were dorks. They thought they were both hot. And their dance move, do you want to show us, TJ, real quick so we can all demonstrate their dance move?
If I remember correctly, it was just like...
Yeah, just go to the left. Everybody go to your left. So that was what they were known for, and that was the meme at the time.
And they play that fucking stupid song. Right. Baby, don't hurt me.
That's really all that was required of the role. He was just over the top, and he did stupid dance moves, but it was always centered around this. And, you know, they would always hit on chicks, and the chicks would never want them.
They actually parlayed that into a film. I mean, I know we're going to get into that later. We talk about film work, but yeah. That thin of a fucking character actually, they got a movie, and it's
beyond
awful.
Sad.
But we'll 100%. Talk about that more in a minute.
Oh, for sure. Yeah, we got more to say about Doug Butabi. We're not done with him, unfortunately.
Doug Butabi. I didn't even know the character had a name.
Well, I didn't either until I started doing this stupid fucking torturous research.
So how many do you want to assess him for that?
At least three. I mean, because I know it's coming, too, so he needs at least three for that. Give him three Biebers.
Three fucking Biebers, dude. Make him a believer.
Just so you know, he's now at 15 Biebers.
But you know what, guys? Well, you know what? Maybe we skip ahead a little bit and look at his one commercial. I mean, do we even want to look at that?
Sure.
He had one commercial. I mean, that's TV work, right?
Yeah,
it was a TV commercial. Yeah,
fair enough.
So if you can find his one commercial.
Yeah, hold on.
I could only find a really, really bad copy of this.
Let's see if I can find it on here. Chris Kattan, stand up. Corky Romano. Is it just this? What's it called? Just Chris Kattan?
Hold on. I'll click on it here and tell you. I mean, the video is called Diet Pepsi Max Super Bowl Ad. Wake up, people.
Okay. Diet Pepsi Max Super Bowl Ad.
Oh, God. I saw this, dude, already. Oh, it's so bad.
You saw it?
Yeah.
It's just, you know.
I remember when it came out and... It's just not a good commercial.
Let's see. Okay, here we go.
And it's a Super Bowl ad, too, so you can tell they spent a bunch of money.
So they spent money on this.
So this is actually an expensive ad, which is sad.
I'll tell you what, his first half has been awfully impressive, and he has looked as comfortable as I've ever seen him in the pocket. This.
What is love? All right, we might have to mute this one.
All right, so yeah, it starts playing that song.
So that's the song that they would bob their head to.
But everyone's
and
nodding.
The joke is just like the guys in that popular thing right now. The song is playing and people are bobbing their head, but it's because they're tired. And what they need is Diet Pepsi Max. I mean, it's just like there's a bunch of celebrities. Busta Rhymes is in there. He's in the theater. There's Missy Elliott. She's in the theater.
Missy Misdemeanor Elliott. Come on, Chris Kattan. Where you at? It's from Pepsi.
Oh, you got to wait for Chris. I'll tell you when. Yeah, there's LL Cool J. He's out there, too. It's like the history of...
Get your energy.
Okay, so here. Pause.
All right.
And unmute it. Oh, there he is. Now,
here's the joke. He's not in on it.
He doesn't like it. He's not even into it.
Stop it.
So he's in there for a second, and he says, stop it!
Stop it!
And even that is annoying. It's the most annoying thing in that horrible commercial.
I guess Will Ferrell wasn't available.
So how many Biebers does he get for that? The last of his TV work that's worth a shit.
He wasn't even the biggest reason why that sucks. I say just one more.
One more.
And I tell you, he's done other things. He's done cameos and shit. And I went digging through the sewers of Chris Kattan.
Ugh.
And there was not a thing that was worth bringing in front of our audience. So I want to give him another four Biebers just for that. He's done a bunch of TV work. And none of it was good enough or featured him enough to justify pulling for this show. So it's all just bit rolls and like, I'm Chris Kattan, I'm doing a cameo. TJ, do your Chris Kattan doing a cameo.
Hey guys, it's me, Chris Kattan. I'm here to do a cameo now. Oh my God, wow, the Chris Kattan, bringing that Chris Kattan into this production. Oh my God, wow. Bet you didn't think it was going to be me, Chris Kattan, showing up on your show, your movie. Oh my God, wow.
So... We've got films to talk about.
Do we?
And just like his
TV... Is that what they're called? Films. Films.
Just like his TV career, they're spotted with bit roles and cameo appearances and joke appearances and appearances as himself, which, you know what? I couldn't find enough of them. So we really boiled it down with him because he really hasn't been in a lot of films in a significant way. But there is one. And that movie is Corky Romano.
Hollywood Pictures Home Video proudly presents...
Coming soon.
Coming soon to theaters.
It's wretched, dude.
From Touchstone Pictures.
Pop's Trial is next.
Yes,
Pop's Trial's next week.
They claim they got an airtight case. Info on the whole organization.
They must have sent some Fed in undercover.
I'm scared of this music, but I'm just gonna fucking pause regularly.
They put somebody undercover. We'll put somebody undercover as an FBI agent to destroy the evidence.
I got someone.
Can we trust him?
He's family.
Whoa, whoa, Leo, you're not talking about Corky.
So, if these guys were in the mob, they would have killed Corky long ago, dude.
Yeah, Corky would be dead.
Corky would have been fucking bludgeoned to death with a pipe at some point.
I don't think there's any other possible recourse.
Oh my god, dude. Motherfuckers act like you forgot about Corky.
In a family of made men, Corky Romano was made of something different.
Scotty, this is horrible, dude.
Dude, a Hollywood executive said yes to this.
Yeah, somebody sitting at a table somewhere was like, yeah!
Chris Kattan, he's going places.
What if Chris Kattan plays one of his over-the-top gay but not gay characters?
They thought it was funny.
But he's related to, like, the mob!
This was funny. The fuck is funny about this?
Ugh.
What fucking unmitigated dog shit this is. Oh my god, I guess I have to press play again. I guess I do.
Do it.
Corkster! Oh man. Someone's like, I kinda like this dude. Fuck you. You're banned from our show.
But now
your family needs you.
The most gentle and caring veterinarian in the world.
But I have animals that depend on me.
Oh, we'll do whatever it takes.
Pull down your pants.
No.
To save his family.
Yeah, or like he would ever say that.
No!
To another man.
I'm respectable. I wouldn't pull down my pants for attention. Yes, you would.
You're Chris Kattan.
Dude, totally Chris Kattan, you're in a movie. You should be thrilled.
Emily.
Corky, I'm not going to give you a wedgie. I'm going to put a wire on you.
I had a little too much coffee. I'm just a little wired.
Get it? I'm just a little wired.
I get it, cause he, yeah.
Dude, he has a fucking anaconda mouth, though.
As in jumpy, I don't mean wire. As in wire in my garage.
Touchstone.
Oh wow, dude.
That's ominous shit.
Riders on the storm.
Hopefully, we don't lose power.
Yeah, hopefully we don't.
If we do, we have an excuse to not do this anymore.
Home Pictures presents Chris Kattan.
You know the drill, take him out.
Chris Kattan is...
Like anyone would give Chris Kattan an M16 or an AR-15 or any fucking gun. I wouldn't give fucking Chris Kattan a pellet gun. Okay.
He may not be the best man for the job.
Hey, you guys want some cookies?
Oh my god, dude.
Welcome to
that.
My nightmare.
I actually remember this part of the trailer for this thing. Of him as the Girl Scout. It's like the only part of the movie I remember, too.
You want to buy some cookies?
He's undercover. He's deep undercover. Get it?
I get it.
It's funny.
Dude, it's like the most amusing fucking shit, dude. So funny. So fucking funny.
Hello,
dude.
Darkness, my old friend. Dude, I just feel like we're staring into the void right now.
I just like every time I press play, I just want to figure out some excuse to stop
the sound
and not look at it anymore. Like I literally press pause and I just look down at the fucking ground. Like okay then, yeah, I'm just gonna kind of not pay attention to the existence of this anymore.
Now he'll have to assume the position.
Why would he act like him getting punched in the balls is some kind of thing for him?
He'd just be like, oh, good try.
Nice try. Nothing down there because I'm Chris Kattan.
What are you doing over there? Come on, get out of there. Let go. Come on. Woo.
Corky Romano.
Dude, Paul's about to get really salty. He lost it.
The salt is about to flow because I don't know where my fucking vape is. Like, it doesn't make any sense. Like, I haven't left the house, you know, unless you know, you guys have a fucking pact. You guys stole it from me while I was in the shitter or some shit. And you were like, let's get Paul real salty for the next thing and not give him his vape.
It's really funny, but we actually didn't think of that.
Yeah, believe me, I'm not looking to be like, let's get Paul really angry and annoying.
That's gonna happen. It's gonna happen already.
Yeah,
without this bullshit,
it's gonna happen worse now.
But anyway, we'll deal with one problem at a time.
Special agent.
I get it.
Special agent.
I agree with that guy.
that guy is the audience.
I agree with that guy right there, dude.
Oh, my God.
How much did Corky Romano actually make?
It's abysmal.
I mean, it was a total flop. Let's see. I'll pull it up. Let's see. Let's pull up statistics on this shit.
On it?
100% abysmal, dude.
I'm guessing about 3% on Rotten Tomatoes, and I'm guessing maybe $3 or $4 million.
Let's see.
And that's being generous.
Corky Romano. Let me look up the Box Office Mojo. Box
Corky.movies.com.
I'm sure that's still around.
Someone had to make a fucking website for this piece of shit fucking movie.
Corky.movie. Oh my god, yeah. God. Can you imagine that being your fucking job, dude?
So hideously enough, this actually made $23 million.
What? Dude, you've gotta be shitting. What was the budget for it?
It doesn't say.
Oh.
But $23 million worth of people got suckered into seeing this
dude, I've seen movies that look, I mean, that are dumb, but should have made more money than this.
Oh, dude, I've seen this movie. This movie is dumber than a bag of fucking hammers.
You've actually seen this movie?
Yes.
Why?
I don't know. I mean, I've seen a lot of shitty movies.
I mean, were you held at gunpoint?
Interestingly enough, no.
So you voluntarily watched this film?
Mm-hmm.
When it came out, or recently?
A tomatoometer of 6% and an audience score of 30. It had been out for like a year or
two when I saw it. I saw it on rental or whatever the fuck. It was terrible. Now, like I said, he's got a bunch of other fucking like half-assed roles in movies and this, that, and the other thing. But at the end of the day, there's really one other movie that we need to mention that he's been in. Because
I'm going to assess.
All right, yeah, oh yeah, that I forgot.
Oh,
we gotta
dude,
assess.
That is at least 5.
I was going to say 10.
Yeah, you know give him 10.
10 is fine, man.
He deserves it.
There's no number that can fucking bomb my fucking eyeballs for witnessing that fucking abomination.
But there's one other movie that he was associated with that we have to talk about. It because just his association with this film is going to earn him Biebers. Chris Kattan played Polar Penguin in Food Fight. And I couldn't even find a clip on the internet of Polar Penguin from Food Fight. But he's one of the most annoying characters. He dies at the end.
In the great battle.
Yeah, well, like the dog, you know, he sacrifices himself to save the dog or whatever the fuck
he's
happens.
He's that fucker?
Know, who cares?
He's yep. that fucker?
Yep.
But fuck this motherfucker, dude.
Yeah, I told you. He plays Polar Penguin.
He plays literally one of the most annoying characters in one of the most annoying movies. I don't even fucking know, dude. Give him a fucking million. Give him a fucking million.
A million?
I think that's a little much.
I mean, I don't know. I hear an argument for it.
I don't know, dude.
I say another 10 for it.
Yeah, 10.
Yeah, 10 at least for this. I mean, it's a bit role. It's not a huge role, but
man. Just being involved in that.
Being involved in food fight. Yeah, dude. He could actually say he was involved in Food Fight.
Oh, my God.
Hideous.
He was probably excited to be in Food Fight,
it's like
dude.
A nightmare come true.
I'm going to be in Food Fight? Awesome.
Yeah, he was in Monkey Bone, that's true.
But also, they made a Night at the Roxbury movie, didn't they?
We'll discuss that later.
But hey guys. He's got stand up. We get to watch some stand up. I mean, how bad could he be at stand up?
Yeah, I don't know. How
bad could he possibly be at...
This is going to be some wacky stand-up, guys.
This is going to be hilarious.
Are you guys ready for the non-stop laugh riot that is Chris Kattan's stand-up?
Dude, I can't even fucking
wait,
dude.
My funny bone is ready, Paul.
I'm ready to laugh.
Tonight on Access TV, it's Gotham Comedy Live.
Yeah, hell yeah.
Get ready to laugh with Court McCown.
Yeah.
Rodriguez. Adrian Minkowitz.
Yeah.
DC
yeah.
Benny. Toast, Chris Kattan.
Woo! Why is he? I mean, he was on SNL. Why is he on an SNL ripoff as well?
I don't know, dude.
Comedy Live. All happening right now. Ladies and gentlemen, Chris Kattan!
How they con these fucking people?
Chris Kattan! Dude, the audience is practically taller than him sitting on the floor when he's standing on a stage, dude. How tall is Chris Kattan?
Probably, he looks like he's like 5'1 or something.
Yeah, he looks like 5'1-ish. I'm looking this up. I want to know how tall Chris Kattan is.
He looks like
is.
Danny DeVito height. Maybe a little bit taller.
If anyone even cares enough about Chris Kattan to fucking tell us his goddamn height. Chris Kattan height. 5'6", my ass.
No fucking way, dude.
There's at least 3 inches added
to that. Yeah, 5'3", is what I'd call him 5'3".
Tops. Tops, dude. There's no fucking way he's 5'6".
5'6" is so generous.
Yes!
Yes! Yes! I'm Chris fucking Kattan! Yes!
It's actually astonishing that someone came to this club knowing he would be there. Like, if you were like, dude, they got some great comedians. They got this guy, and they got this guy. Oh, and Chris Kattan's hosting. I'd just be like, no.
Nope.
Nope, pass. Next.
Sorry, can't do it. Chris Kattan, nope.
Welcome to Gotham Comedy Live!
All right.
Wow. Yeah.
Yeah.
You guys are insane!
Is he drunk? Just
brush your fucking hair, Chris Kattan.
It's the first time everyone's back into the U.S.? Is that what happened? What happened tonight? Well, it is...
Is he, like, trying to talk deeper just because he's used to playing, like, super effeminate characters?
Is this...
Oh, I'm Chris Kattan. How are you doing?
Is this been altered, or is it... This is him... What is going on with his voice?
This is me, Chris Kattan. I am a manly man now.
You think he's drunk or something?
I'm honored to be here. I'm so excited.
He sounds like he's trying to do a Brendan Fraser impression.
He sounds like fucking... Like, he's trying to do Wild... what's his name? Yeah, like, fucking Wild Bill from The Silence of the Lambs. Hello.
It puts the lotion on its skin or else it gets the hose again.
Is Chris Kattan really a serial killer, dude?
You're all going to be put to sleep in about 10 seconds. I'm sorry.
That's
I'm so
accurate.
Excited to be here. You guys, let me just get this out of the way if I could very quickly, just to get it out of the way.
It's hard for me to fall asleep when I'm being tortured, Chris.
Oh, wow. You're still riding that one.
Yeah, I can still do the whole hand bobbing my head like that. You know, that's still a thing I do.
Remember?
Chris Kattan.
That's probably the only thing anyone knows him for.
What in love, baby, don't hurt me. Don't hurt
dude,
me.
Dude, look at that look on his face. Dude. That's the look of a defeated and broken man.
The way it stopped, it looks like he doesn't even have a mouth. It just kind of it blurred out to now. It just,
you know what? That would be a welcome fucking
change. It
looks
change. Like that creepy scene in The Matrix where like Neo's mouth vanishes.
How will you make a call, Mr. Anderson?
Thank you.
Thank you, one
I call
person.
That the death of me? I know that someday I'll be in my casket and someone will come over and go, oh, that's too bad. Let's just bop his head one more time.
Ha ha!
No.
I am uncomfortable with my legacy.
No, it's going to happen. Do you guys mind if I talk a little bit about my SNL characters? Is that all right? Was that all right?
Please don't. Yeah!
That's all I got.
Yeah.
That's really all I got. Another
you don't even
I
got
did
that.
Was,
wow, that's not even a thing to have.
I mean, Jesus, like...
Ready Sniper 1, hell yeah. I'm a sniper. Nah, nah.
Can I, like, talk about this thing you might remember
before? Why does everybody think I'm the homo gay?
That was a gay character I did. It was funny to see the kind of people that liked the characters I did. Like, for example, the Mango. Older Asian men liked Mango. And young children like Mango. That's not healthy. This little kid came up to me in a supermarket. He's really excited to meet me. He's like, oh, my God, you do the Mango. And I was, yeah, I do. And he turned around super confident, and he went, you can't have...
What is this?
Vanilla, no! Vanilla, dude, no!
Why did fucking Vanilla Ice not save the world and bash his brains in? Vanilla, no!
He could have saved us all. He could have saved us all.
Dude, if Vanilla Ice had just turned around and smashed the baseball bat against Chris Kattan's skull, the universe have been put into balance. The
worst case scenario, manslaughter.
But he didn't do it.
People, look, the jury would have understood. It's like, he'd be like, yo, you know what? It's like Chris Kattan. You know what I'm saying? They'd been like,
You know what? I do know what you're saying.
Not guilty. Jury nullification.
Not guilty. Is not murder when it's Chris Kattan.
We find you guilty, but we fucking give you no time.
Murder is all right in it's called the Chris Kattan defense.
And in fact, we award you $10 million.
Vanilla! No!
Dude, the jury should fucking award him fucking money.
Yeah, in fact, yeah, they should fucking... Chris Kattan's family should have to pay restitution to Vanilla Ice for forcing him to have to do it.
Seems fair.
Chris Kattan reminds me of evil reality Brendan Fraser. He sounds like he's trying to do a Brendan Fraser impression in this.
I think he's just drunk.
Oh, I'm Chris Kattan.
I'm Chris Kattan.
You might remember me from Saturday Night Live. I was on it for several years. I did the Saturday Night Live. I was a mango, you know, and I'm manger. You know, people liked it.
No.
Don't do that. Good no stuff back then. You know, a lot of people thought it was pretty funny when I was mango, you know?
Another character I did was Mr. Peepers. Remember that thing?
Oh, yeah, no. Remember I did Mr. Peepers. I did Peepers. And when Peepers would go poopers, he'd peep on the poopers. I'm Chris Kattan, everybody.
A lot of excitement there. And I got to do it with a lot of great guest hosts. The Rock was one of the memorable ones. Yeah
The Rock. Whoa.
Big man. He's got a lot of skin, Dwayne. For some reason, he's seen...
Bring on the purge, Bring on the purge, it's all right.
As much skin as everybody else. For some reason, it seems like he's got more skin than other people because he's so big and he's got veins and he's smooth. Smooth man. Very smooth man. And in this Mr. Peepers plot, he wanted to be Mr. Peepers' dad. So he had to wear the exact same outfit I did. You know, it was like these suspenders and the ears and all this stuff. And he was dressed up like me, so...
Dun 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 dun.
Godspeed, TJ. Man, TJ's dead now. Can't really blame him though. How do you blame someone after they watch this shit? Doing this show for like 13 hours and your fucking your goddamn reward is Chris Kattan. Fuck life and fuck reality.
Right now, my reward is my vape. Dude, which one of you fuckers stole it?
I don't
the last
have it,
time
dude.
My vape went missing,
I do not
it was
have
because
it.
You faggots hid it.
What?
Who did it?
Who yeah, hid the true. Vape?
I do not have
you
your
remember
vape.
Remember the whole I left my vape at TJ's house thing? It was in a cabinet at your house because you guys hid it.
No one hid it.
Was it?
Yes!
I didn't take your vape, dude. Mm-hmm. I wouldn't steal a man's vape, dude. That's fucked up. Plus, I don't want to deal with your Nick Fiending ass.
I feel like I saw it somewhere.
I thought it was in the kitchen.
Yeah, I feel like I mean, I feel like when I left this room, I saw it.
Vanilla, no!
Yeah, that's the problem. It's like, I didn't go anywhere, but the vape is gone!
Dude, Paul's having a mental breakdown.
Paul's just like scrounging around the house, like, where the fuck is the vape?
The mental collapse of Paul.
I mean, at this point, what does he have?
What the fuck does he have? We're sitting here, we're watching fucking Chris Kattan. I think he lost his own damn vape, so he didn't have to watch his Chris Kattan shit. He's just like, I'm looking for my vape, guys. Excuse me.
Everyone I know
gets to vape.
It's even better.
In the end. And you could have it all.
That's sweet.
Just don't steal my vape. I will choke it down, my bubblicious grape. Poor Paul, dude.
Paul's to the point where he thinks we stole it, dude.
Paul's like, where the fuck is where you stole
that? That is
guys?
The cry of a desperate man when you start blaming, like, you know what? I know you guys fucking took it.
Scotty stole it! Kenny stole it!
Dude, what if Stevie took it, dude?
Dude, what if fucking Stevie's right now going...
Yeah, Stevie's Bubba fucking sitting great. There sucking on a vape somewhere, like...
Paul insults me in the forge! Now I take his vape to make him suffer and feel the suffering and pain of those who are not skilled with the forge.
Oh, dude, I love it, dude. Stevie's revenge.
Stevie strikes back, dude.
Your Bubblicious vape is mine now, Paul.
It is a sweet prize that I take from you,
dude,
Paul.
Stevie's got it. What a little fucker. I knew it was him.
Oh, dude. Paul's in that... He's in that state where it's like he doesn't know what to do.
No, it's not even that, dude. Like,
Paul is slowly losing
honestly,
his mind.
It hasn't been that long since I had it, so I'm not nicotine fiending. It's the idea that I've got 12 more hours of this shit, and it's a problem that has to be solved. And somewhere between now and then, and now
oh,
is better.
Oh, you're good, Paul. There's only like 11 hours.
No, fuck that. Don't,
only
you 11 don't know
hours,
good.
Paul. it's only 11 more hours to go.
11 foot high and rising.
We're already halfway done, Paul.
What the fuck?
Did you look up on there?
I've looked everywhere.
If you looked everywhere, you would have found it.
But my
fingers. Paul like reaching into his butthole.
Is it not my butt?
There's a piece of corn, but there's no fucking goddamn vape, is there?
This is bizarre, dude. The mystery of Paul's vape.
Did you check the couch where he was sitting?
Did you sit on the couch in the living room at all? I've checked the best I can. Let's pull it out a little bit. Tear the studio down.
Tear down the wall. Tear down the wall.
Leave this place until the vape is
two
found.
Men enter, one man leave.
Who has taken the vape? Your crimes will be punished.
Two Biebers for triggering Paul. I don't think Chris Kattan is the one who triggered Paul here, though.
Well, I mean, kinda, yeah. I need a vape to get through this.
He needs the vape to face down the horrors of Chris Kattan.
Oops. Son of a bitch. You wanna lift it? The topsy-turvy. I guess we could look underneath the front part here.
Man, they're desperate.
They? Scotty's just helping. All right.
And I'm just vamping. Well, it's time for my one-man show. Nope. Check this out. I make fire! Whoa!
That excludes this, at least.
What the fuck happened to Paul's fucking vape, dude?
I don't know.
I make fire.
It's ridiculous.
Good stuff. You guys want to see the different transitions I can do? Check this out. Let's change to a different transition. This is RGB channel transition. Whoa, what's that? That's some pretty crazy shit, huh? Huh? You know what's what. You stupid fuckers know what's what. Toss the house. Burn the house to the fucking ground. It's time for the Paul's Lost His Vape segment. Featuring TJ vamping for time while Paul and Scotty try to find the elusive Bubblicious Great Vape. Yeah, bitch. I'll just use this opportunity to put Frollo back on the fucking list, you know? I think it was fucked up the way that they took Frollo off of there. It's time to right the wrongs of history. Where'd it fucking go, even? Damn, Scotty's back in here. What a turd. What a fucking turd, eh?
Did you steal Paul's vape?
I didn't steal nothing.
Well, I'm just asking Paul here anymore.
Yeah, I didn't steal it. What the fuck? Why would I steal his vape?
You're mad at him, dude.
I don't want this.
I do not want this.
It's derailing the fucking show. Setting the fucking... It's off track now.
It's not my fault.
Cat! What the fuck?
Squeaks, get out of here.
No.
Squeaks, get out of here. Eh.
God damn it. Pull my microphone out.
Nope, now they want the damn thing. Squeaks, get out of here. Squeaks, get out of here.
Fucking cat's invading now. Where is he?
He's hiding, dude. He's in the fucking blanket. He's in the backdrop.
Squeaks, come the fuck here, dude. Ooh, look. You wanna get it? Get it.
Oh, fucking cat, dude. Toss him out into the fucking rain. Toss him into the gutter. Go out there and throw him in a garbage can. Don't talk to Squeaks that way. Fuck you. Fuck you, bitch. You're a fucking retard.
Wasn't he supposed to come fix this?
Yeah, he never did.
What a fucking piece of shit, dude.
He never did. The turd. The piece of fucking useless
fucking
goddamn
he
garbage.
Show up his fucking job. He was here. He could fucking show up for the show. Yeah, nice try, Squeaks.
Well, you know what? This is a good time as any to show you guys something. You guys are familiar with Lil Pump's Eskidit, I'm assuming. Let me show you the reaction that... let's see where I am with this one so I can get back to... Oh my god, it's so long. Whatever. I showed Eskidit to my mom and my stepdad, Steve, who was here earlier. So let's take a look at that to kill some time while Paul looks for his vapey-wapey. This is never before vapey, seen. Vapey. Never before seen shit from my mom and from Steve.
It was pretty freaking lame. The only thing he said was pumping all X. And I couldn't figure out if the guy was white, although he did have some fine bitches that were in there that I would definitely, don't tell them your mom, but that's, they had some fine business in there. But it was a stupid video because it did the same thing over and over and over. It never changed. It was the same thing. And the guy had the same dance move. He grabbed his cock and bounced on one leg.
That was fucking awful. Why? Why? Okay, I liked his hair when it was purple. And I would have worn some of those clothes if I could get away with it. But on a guy?
That's just crazy. But yeah, that, I thought it was a very lame video. I wouldn't go to buy it. And I wouldn't recommend anybody to buy it whatsoever. Because, you know, I'd stick to country myself. I'm done. I mean, I used to rap when I was young. But you used to be able to understand the words. Now it's like, I wonder if I can. It's like, how to go. It goes, bit of the pip, bit of the pip. Pumping on eggs, pills. Yeah. That's a role model. I'd definitely gonna take his advice and go get a bunch of X pills right now and pump it all in. Is that what the little pump stands for? I guess.
Maybe so.
It's the little pump that allows you to pump the X pills. I don't know.
Oh, I'm like, why is he talking about all these eggs?
Oh, X, dude.
Oh, X. X. Got it. Okay. I thought he was pumping on eggs. I'm like.
Pumping on eggs.
What do you do with eggs? You know something I don't know? Okay. I hope to God this is like not popular. 161 million views. Can I put a thumbs down?
Yeah, go ahead.
TJ, that's awful.
Really? They watched that many times? That's,
yeah.
Dude, I mean, that's, God, just think if I had that many leads. That is awesome, man. And just by saying pump it on X, but you know what it draws? It's not him, it's the girls in the video.
And the money.
And the money is what draws people to check that video out. Money draws everything. But yeah, I thought it was a shitty video. And I'm going to go pump it up on X.
I mean, it was just awful. It's like he doesn't have any brain cells or something. Maybe he X'd them all out or eggs'd them all out. He ate too many eggs.
There you go. Little journey. Paul's still...
The mental collapse of Paul is just
the
still...
The mental collapse of Paul. Man, I thought Paul would take at least longer than this to mentally
The mental
implode.
Collapse of Paul,
oh,
dude.
I see he's holding his vape. Where was it?
It's not my vape. It's a fucking other vape. Oh. Another fucking shit.
Ah, dude.
Fucking area, just to make sure.
I ain't got it.
Do pat downs later, gentlemen.
I ain't fucking got it, Paul.
All right, it's fine. It'll turn up.
One of these days.
In the meantime,
Paul has a backup vape.
A backup vape.
Yeah, I have the backup. I have the backup vape here. It'll work for the
vape
time being.
2.0 or vape 1.0.
Yeah.
To which the missing one is the 2.0.
Yeah. I mean, whatever, dude. I don't know. It grew legs. It's one of those things that happens.
All right. Well, back to the comedy stylings of the great Chris Kattan. Let's go back.
Tonight on Access TV.
You guys, let me just get this out of the way if I could very quickly, just to get it out of the way.
Is he going to pull a gun out and shoot himself in the head?
Then I'd actually like it.
Could he get that out of the way really quickly?
Thank you. I call that the death of me.
The death of
someday
you?
Someday I'll be in my casket and someone will come over and go, oh that's too bad. Let's just part. That's where I did the half man, half monkey, and ate an apple, and then dry humped somebody's face. It was very, a lot of excitement there. And I got to do it with a lot of great guest hosts. The Rock was one of the memorable ones.
The Rock was one of the memorable
Dwayne
ones.
Johnson, the Dwayne Rock Johnson, Big Man. He's got a lot of skin.
The Rock was Dwayne. One of the memorable ones.
He's got a lot of skin.
Dwayne's
guy.
Got a lot
guy.
Of skin.
Like, what's Rock like? He's like a huge guy, massive guy. A lot of skin.
We already actually know that about
the skin.
You know, when
else.
People ask you what The Rock is like, they're probably not expecting you to say, he's big. We
you know
that.
He's big.
People want to know about his fucking personality, bitch.
That's the brilliant observational humor of Kattan, TJ.
He's dude, you met Wesley Snipes? What's he like? Oh, he's black.
Oh, wow.
You wouldn't believe it.
Dude, I never would have thought that about Wesley Snipes.
You know
Snipes.
What also? Doesn't like to pay his taxes.
Wow.
For some reason, it seems like he's got more skin than other people because he's so big. And he's got veins and he's smooth.
He's
smooth
got veins?
Very smooth, man. And in this...
Someone just submitted $6.66, which I wouldn't respond to that by itself,
right.
But what accompanied it is actually good. They called it hashtag cringe Kattan.
Yes.
Yeah. Mr. Peeper's plot. He wanted to be Mr. Peeper's dad.
Look at him. He's talking about Mr. Peeper. That's an achievement in his life and not an embarrassing
chapter.
He's
going through all of his SNL characters here. He's just talking about him. He's not doing him or anything.
Oh, he doesn't care.
He's just talking about him.
Paul, and it's killing. The audience is...
Look at
them. I did, you know, it was like
they're rolling in the aisles,
and ears, and all this stuff.
It's
and,
silence.
he was dressed up like me, so this is kind of weird. He was
one person awkwardly laughed
and stuff in this outfit because he was showing a lot of skin. He standing just like from here to the exit sign. He kind of looked like a big tall cock.
Oh my God, that's the most
there.
Hilarious! A
looked
big
like the Rock,
tall
like,
cock.
The Rock. The Rock looks like a big tall cock.
There's a big tall pee-pee.
Wow, dude. Is he still telling the same jokes he used to tell in the ninth grade?
He looked so much like a cock, I wanted to suck him!
You know what Mr. Robinson that teaches science looks like? He looks like a big, tall cock. I bet that used to slay at the Zen Buddhist middle school, too. That's why he's still using... Why does he seem like he's on, like, downers or something, too?
Yeah, he's on something,
we
dude.
Figure out that he's, like, drunk or on pills or something.
Yeah, I'm guessing it's drunk, but we'll get to that later.
Just like a giant, huge cock.
Yeah, like a giant,
like a little
huge
penis with a back
cock. Man, his...
And there was, you know, during rehearsal, I was in the Mr. Peepers, and he was the Papa Peepers, and I was... Does anybody remember any of this? What's happening?
No.
Okay, perfect. I'm going to try to get laid out of this show somehow or another. I don't know. I got 9 minutes. So anyway, so I was on top of this. I was on top of the Rock, and I was like sliding a bit because the Rock sweats. And the Rock sweats a lot, more than most people. Not that I'm used to a lot of sweat in my life from other people. But the Rock, he sweats a lot. So I was like sliding. And I don't know if you do this, but when I get scared, I get effeminate. You know, if like...
What do you mean when you get... Are you scared
or are you just
time?
Always scared? Yeah.
Perpetually on the verge of a nervous
perpetually
breakdown.
Perpetually frightened because you're always effeminate.
Vanilla, first. No!
There's a fire or something. I go, oh, a fire! I don't know why. I do. If I even spill coffee, I'd be like, oh, coffee! I just happen to do that. So when I was on top of the Rock, I was sliding.
These people are smiling.
Oh, I'm sliding. The Rock's slippery. Like that. And he turned around and went, you okay, little buddy? It's a very awkward moment in my life. And then a few weeks later...
So, like every other moment, or...
Yeah. Cameron. Diaz, she was on the show. It was like, she's so hot.
God, name dropping like a motherfucker.
Woman I've ever seen. Beautiful.
I met The Rock.
Anybody know Cameron Diaz?
I know Cameron Diaz.
Not Dwayne The Rock Johnson.
I would slay that pussy, dude. I'm so straight.
Well, he's trying to talk deep here. He's like, yeah,
guys.
Perfect.
I'm the new Chris Kattan.
Dude, it sounds like a kid calling up like,
yes, please excuse Alex from school today. Is Wang there? Is Wong there?
This is I'm Kevin McAllister, the father.
The father.
That's fucking haunted.
Oh, yeah, this woman. Perfect body. Just like, it's like, bam, like, pow, like, meow.
Oh, my God.
Bang, like, pow, like, meow.
Bang, like, pow, like, meow.
No wonder he was fucking cast in Food Fight.
Like, gag. Like, puke. Like, fuck this dupe. Have you genuinely even chuckled?
Dude, no one there has. The best he's gotten is the polite, this is funny, right? Wrong.
If some of the rigging equipment above him fell and crushed him, I laughed then.
Yes!
Yeah, you're right.
Oh my God, that'd be beautiful.
But the crazy thing is, I was excited to do the Mr. Peepers character. Her, other than the cock, would be great. Anything
what other, any other names you want
to
drop?
But I'm so excited that to meet this woman, because she was my first, right? You know.
But hang on, with me, you know, me and Tom. Tom Cruise.
It's my first time I masturbated to a woman was to her. Last time as well.
By the way, that's not the way it sounds. Sounds. It's a little bit more like a...
So he's of, like, the Kathy Griffin school of comedy. Like, just talk, no punchline, keep going.
Something like that. More like that. We'll talk about it later. But, anyway.
Why?
So I was so nervous about meeting her. And when I was meeting her, I was like, oh, my God. Just like an out-of-body experience. And she's so flawless, so beautiful. But the crazy thing is, she's so perfect. But when she laughs, when Cameron Diaz laughs, she goes... I was like, whoa, what the fuck is that? So it didn't make any sense. It was like, bam, bam, boom, and then,
What about
like,
the noises that come out of your mouth every time you open it? Like, how could you ever be Chris Kattan and criticize somebody for having a goofy laugh?
Yeah, she gets a fucking pass, dude. She overall is just normal. You're a fucking just
I mean,
troll.
She might be a crazy bitch, but compared to him...
Whoa.
Whoa, dude, that was an edgy transition,
that was trippy,
TJ.
Dude. You look broken and defeated,
TJ. Do you
want
to keep torturing yourself with more of this, or you know, are we willing to assess? Because I couldn't find any other.
She sounded like Bugs Buzzard from Bugs Bunny cartoons. You know? Oh nope.
Let's just see if any of us laugh.
To make any sense. Anyway, this is a very exciting time in my life. Now I'm 78 years old and dead. We have a great show tonight. Is anybody here getting married or fiance? You're a male, but you're getting married. You're getting married to this lovely lady? You just pointed. Unless she changed. Did you change your mind? Oh, that's.
What?
500,000 points.
I mean, I gotta agree. I mean, like, how do you even assess enough fucking Biebers to make this worthwhile?
I mean, okay.
I mean, I have to have a limit, so I'd say 10.
No, more than that. It's gotta be more.
15. He deserves 15 for his.
Damn,
because I gotta be honest. He does. There are other videos of him doing stand up out there, but all of them are like filmed from somebody's phone, 16 rows back, and it's almost inaudible. But I can extrapolate that they're all just as bad, if not worse, than this. So I think 15 is fair. So
what about crowning achievement?
Do you want to do that first, or do you want to do the where are they now first?
What's the best thing he's done?
We traditionally do where are they now at the last thing. But if you want to do it in a different order, that's fine.
I mean, his crowning achievement was...
I don't even know what it could be is why. I know he's nowhere now.
I mean, with a guy like Kattan, you just got to pick sometimes the least stinky turd. And for him, in terms of just the amount of money that was made and all of that, it is A Night at the Roxbury. Which is a spinoff film that was made about his character, Doug Boutabi, along with Will Ferrell. And it's basically a movie that's just a longer sketch from Saturday Night Live, where they go from club to club and they bob their heads. And
it's a terrible
fucking
film.
And chicks aren't into them and they think they are, and they're always mistaken about everything.
That's it. Whoa, it's not available.
Okay. Whoops.
Trust me, that this You're not, did you a favor.
You're not missing anything.
It's the fucking Saturday Night Live sketch stretched into an unnatural, horrible hour and a half.
It's something like
of a movie.
They're coming, like from what I remember, like they're coming on to some, or he's coming on to some woman. They work at their dad's flower shop, or no, fake plant shop.
Yeah, and they it's like dress absurd. Up like there's a whole scene that's like built around them using those like nose hair trimmers that hurt. And, like, there's just a whole scene of them doing it and screaming in different ways and being all girly about it.
I mean, the only smart thing that Chris Kattan did but was...
If you could look up the box office, TJ...
Was he fucking... He was smart enough to leech off Will Ferrell as long as he could.
Oh, yeah, for sure. He was lucky to even be in the presence of Will Ferrell.
Yeah, he really was. What do you want to assess for this?
I mean...
Maybe 5. I mean, it's a pretty awful movie, but...
I gotta be honest with you, dude. Back in the day when this movie came out and these guys were still cool, like these characters were cool, this movie still sucked.
Oh, like, yeah. It sucked. People hated it back then.
Yeah, so it was, I mean, I don't know. Some people liked it.
It made $30 million, so, you know.
I mean, that's a pretty successful. It's more successful than Corky Romano was by marginally, $5 million.
You know, I mean, so. I'd say we've given him 20, 15. I mean, 5 seems like a pretty reasonable fucking penalty.
Remember that this is the crowning achievement.
I mean, the
of
best
life.
Thing he ever did was The Night at the Roxbury. I guess 5 is fine. I mean, we don't want to overload him here.
Yeah, especially because we haven't known where are they now yet.
So
where is he now?
Well, there's a few things we can watch for that. I have a news interview that's relatively recent. It's from 2017.
That's pretty
it's
recent.
It's like a local news interview where he's going to be doing some stand-up.
All right, so is that the one that's just called Chris Kattan?
It might be.
Or Night at the Roxbury.
Yep,
back in the studio, Chris Kattan's in the studio.
Woo, the crowd went so much. Crowd went wild.
Oh my god! Awful here, by the way.
I know,
dude.
Does
he look like he just has been in a crypt for about 6 weeks?
Dude, he looks like someone's fucking like caricature.
I have been awoken from my slumber.
Dude, it looks like he's been on like a 48 to 72 hour coke binge with Andy Dick or something.
We've only reached the third
day. Did he always have Steven Tyler sized lips? Because I'm not noticing that until now.
There's a lot of weird things. I mean, his face has always been weird, but it's just getting weirder as he gets
older.
He's
becoming a vampire, dude.
Yeah.
He's just fucking changing.
Nosferatu.
I am a creature of the night, Chris Kattan.
I just want to apologize. We showed that video of me with my shirt off and Hasselhoff.
Was that you?
That was me, and you started choking, and I felt really bad. Are you okay?
I thought that was from the movie.
Oh, he's drunk again, dude.
I know. I'm Chris Kattan.
When you see him in the 2000s, he always seems kind of like a little tipsy, doesn't he? Like, there's some, or something's wrong. He's off. There's something off about him.
I have to be drunk to deal with the fact that I'm Chris Kattan.
I know what it is. I know what's off about him. He's Chris Kattan.
Well, I mean, that glaringly obvious. But I'm saying, like his speech patterns, like, there's something.
Yeah, he's on something.
He's on something, yeah.
Let's listen to a little bit more of this.
Happening? I know.
I didn't know that was you, though.
Oh, yeah.
You look great.
Thanks.
We don't want him to talk again. Muscles can deteriorate like that. No, but you look good. As long as that CW31 blocks you. How'd you get David Hasselhoff to do this?
He just came roaming through.
Dude, if I risen to the level of David Hasselhoff,
Wow, you're showing a clip with David Hasselhoff?
Is Chris Kattan fat now?
He is kind of tubbed up a little bit, it looks like.
Yeah, he looks a little chunky.
It's just a little beer belly.
Walking around.
He sat right
here.
He
doesn't look really fat.
He
looks a little bit.
Like,
It's just the layers. It's just the layers, too.
Funny.
I'm sure he was. He drinks. No, I'm joking.
What's
I'm paid to laugh, so I'm
sorry. What's funny right now?
You're a comedian. I have to laugh at your jokes.
You know, I mean, he's just like, who's fucking laughing at this? Who at home even remembers who Chris Kattan is, let alone is laughing at this?
These two people probably to get like, okay, Chris Kattan was big in the 90s.
Remember that time he was Mango Hat?
Oh, Night at the Roxbury. Yeah, I think I saw that when I was like 25. I got this interview.
It's ridiculous.
Remember Chris Kattan, you guys?
All right, let's hear some more shit.
So that's fun to have him.
Yeah, it was fun. It was good times.
Am I like David Hasselhoff for today? I'm like,
you're the guy.
No.
Except you're in a different chair.
No, I'd rather not.
You're in the better chair.
I have to apologize about something else.
Okay, please do.
A few years back,
I was at the Kentucky Derby.
Yeah. Was I there?
Yes, you were.
What was I doing?
And I saw you from a distance. I was a little inebriated, and I said, Chrissy Tan!
Wow. Do you remember that guy?
You dressed up in the Baywatch thing?
He had a big hat. No, he had a big hat.
No,
big hat.
And then the next season is when you did that substitute teacher that nobody could understand.
Oh,
and I thought
kidding
maybe
me?
That was
I can't
me
understand him now.
It was.
Wow,
it was
this interview is just painful.
But I'm glad that you thought it was about you. No,
like that
it was
Carly
not
Simon song.
I love how we're like, I think he was doing me, and everybody got up.
Why wouldn't he have been?
But no. But I'm sorry I didn't remember that.
No, it's okay.
All right.
I should add.
Did you do a little line of coke there? Like his little emergency line? Oh, yeah. I'm sorry I didn't remember that.
Sorry. Oh, my
this
God.
This is so
dude
fucking awful, dude. Even in an interview.
I mean, these news personalities are awful. They're almost as empty and reprehensible as he is. Just
well,
almost.
They're pretending to find him funny. That's even
which
worse.
Is, yeah.
You know, Chris no Kattan,
way,
nah.
You know there's no way any of these people think he's fucking funny.
What has he even said? I don't even understand a goddamn word.
But you were wearing a hat and what else?
Just,
that's it.
Probably about
that's it.
Yeah.
That's probably it.
Probably
Chris Kattan.
Juleps can only have one. You
yeah,
really
juleps
have
is a good word for
you can't have juleps.
So, yeah, that's this. How many are we going to give him for
five
this?
Yeah, another
five of these.
Another
yeah
five.
Seven.
I mean, oh, God, it's awful. But that's the, but that, that's not all we have for Where Is He Now. But that's just, you know, we're going to go one by one here. All
right.
The next thing is pretty recently, Chris Kattan got a DUI.
What?
Yeah, a DUI. And unlike most celebrities, he managed to get himself filmed while taking the sobriety
I'm this
test.
This is like a picture of him. In that.
This is on the left is his mugshot from this DUI.
Cool. So we have a video.
So he looks like
DUI
that dude that pretends to be Peter Pan
dude,
now.
He kind of yeah, dude.
You remember that guy that thinks he's Peter Pan, but he's like 60 years old?
Yeah.
I'm Peter Pan.
So here's the DUI.
It's a DUI lawyer now.
Chris
Kattan's
mom.
Oh shit! He crashed, dude.
Crashed it up pretty bad, you guys.
Damn, he caused a fucking traffic jam,
he
dude.
He wrecked it something. There he is. You can kind of see him there being interviewed by the officer.
I don't know what happened, Ossifer.
And he does a great job taking the sobriety test, too, by the way. As you'll see soon.
Oh, fuck. Did he fucked up the front of his car, dude?
Well, he's getting the finger in the face.
I want you to drink tonight, there. Just a couple beers.
I played Mango.
This is how you walk in a straight line.
Yeah, so here's... Yep, your turn, Chris Kattan.
Don't worry, Chris. We're sure you're going to pass the test.
You got this, Chris.
Oh, here he goes.
Oh, my God.
Wow, that was great.
Good job, Chris. Nailed it.
You've done a fantastic job, Chris.
Don't worry, Chris. I'm sure they're just going to escort you back to the your car. You're free to go about your business. Call
point
cab. You know,
so most celebrities that get caught with this shit don't end up on tape like this. So that's, you know, pretty humiliating for him.
I mean, he's probably.
I mean, is he really
even
a celebrity?
Calling him a celebrity so.
Yeah, I mean, that's,
yeah, whatever.
That's generous calling him a celebrity to begin with.
You're right.
Well, I mean, what you don't see after this is he's escorted off to the side of the road. They call him a cab and he goes home.
Give him three more. For
clearly
this
sober.
Give him three more for that.
So he does have a drinking problem.
Then we got kind of a weird one for the last Where Are They Now and the final part of Chris Kattan. We're almost done, guys. But there's a weird one. Pull up that last news story, TJ. The Blaze one.
Update. Actor drops stunning abuse allegations against former SNL castmate Norm MacDonald in bizarre interview. All right. During a radio interview meant to promote his weekend comedy gig in St. Louis, former Saturday Night Live cast member Chris Kattan leveled some serious charges against another former cast member, Norm MacDonald, claiming MacDonald sexually abused and physically abused an assistant.
Whoa, named
Lori
dude.
Joe. Speaking with KPNT Radio's Rizzuto show on Friday, Kattan was asked about a story claiming he and MacDonald were not on good terms. The host, Rizzuto, asked Kattan, "Is that true you and Norm MacDonald hated each other?" Kattan quickly responded, "We didn't hate each other. The actor, famous for his iconic characters like male dancer Mongo or Mango,
You can't have a Domingo.
Did say McDonald was one of those people that was a little ticked off that I was doing well, which I understand. I think reality was upset about that.
I think Norm just hated him because he's unfunny and sucks.
Catan shared a story of a prank McDonald played on him during a cross-country flight that escalated into a confrontation during an SNL pitch meeting. Garth Brooks was slated to guest host that week, and Catan claims he stated he wanted to do a Mango sketch. According to Catan, McDonald replied, "Nobody wants to do a sketch with a
dude." Norm McDonald's fucking funnier just in an off-the-cuff fucking pitch meeting than fucking Catan has ever been in his life.
Catan claims he responded with outspoken honesty, saying, "Norm, go sexually abuse your assistant." Well, it sounds like you told him to do it, you know?
Well, he sounds like he's trying to make a little backhanded allegation that Norm has done that in the past.
Right. After an uncomfortable moment of silence, Catan continued, "Because that's what he did, usually." Rizzuto asked, "Are you saying Norm McDonald beat up his assistant?" Said, "I don't know, but she had a black eye and was like, that would happen every so often."
So Norm McDonald used to have an assistant he used to beat up?
Yeah, just beat her up.
Okay.
Appearing to distance himself from his previous statement, Catan added, "No, she did not, unless she fell." Oh, wait, so someone says, "Wow, she really fell down the steps a lot." And Catan said, "No, she did not, unless she fell down the steps and her pants were off, maybe."
So he's saying he wasn't beating her up, he was raping her.
Rape a bitch.
Or, like, extorting sex out of her, or whatever the fuck you want to say.
Rizzuto spoke with The Blaze on Friday, described the entire 45-minute interview as an 8-car pileup you could not stop watching. The host also told us he was trying to get Catan to confirm the charges he was leveling against his former co-star, repeating, "Wait, she slipped, fell, her pants were off? I think he hit her. That what I think, but that was a while ago," said Catan.
"That what I think.
I that think what I think.
That what I think."
So you guys can give me some more booze money for this interview?
The Blaze attempted to contact Mr. McDonald and Mr. Catan for comment. Neither one has returned our call.
Wisely so.
I say he deserves more points for that.
Oh, for sure.
How many more?
At least 5. I'd be willing to hear more than that, to be honest with you.
I was at 5, too.
Dude, you know what? You should have waited for the Me Too movement, dude.
There's a little more to this story, too, with his little feud with Norm. He was on Howard Stern one time.
Yeah.
Chris Kattan was. And he was telling stories about SNL. And he told this story, like, Howard hit on this, like, "Oh, I heard you and Norm kind of don't like each other." He's like, "No, you know, I like Norm. You know, I like him, okay." It's like, there's this weird thing that happened, though. And he tells this story, right, about... There's a photo shoot with a bunch of the members of SNL. And he tells this story about how Norm showed up in the middle of it and demanded to be in the center of the picture. And all this shit. Like, Norm was acting like a big old prima donna in Chris's story, right? And like, I don't know, 3/4 of the way through Chris Kattan's story, Artie Lang, who's a personal friend of Norm's, calls up, happened to be there or whatever, like, had firsthand, like, and he was like, "That's not how it went at all." He's like, "Norm was just late, like Norm always was, but Norm was always supposed to be at the middle of that photo because he was the best thing they had." And I don't know where Chris got this idea that he shoved himself in there. Like I said, the photo shoot got delayed because Norm was late. So Chris got basically caught with his pants down telling a total lie.
Yeah, just like Norm was always intended to be the star.
On live radio, you know. So I want to give him an extra one, so let's give him 6. He deserves at least one for that bullshit. Yeah,
forget a fucking bullshit fucking story about this guy.
He's caught with his pants down around his ankles on Howard Stern.
Yeah, Norm McDonald's a piece of shit.
It's like,
why? Because he's actually did something with his life, unlike you. He's actually fucking funny. Can actually make people laugh. I'm a fucking chimpanzee!
That puts his final score at 76.
Wow.
I mean, I feel like it should be higher.
You know what? Give him another 5.
Yeah.
So 81.
Fuck this bitch, dude. Give him another fucking 5.
Yeah. 76 just seems criminally low.
81 seems better.
Yep. So who's next?
So we'll just assess like a +5 handicap for being Chris Kattan.
Why not?
Who's next? Carlos Menstelia, dude. The great Carlos Menstelia. He was hard to find too young of a picture of, but here he is, semi-young.
Oh, wow.
Looks like a douche.
He just exudes the air of douche, does he not?
Hey, look at me, I'm a douche.
Just want to let you guys know that I'm a fucking douchebag. Carlos Mencia.
You know what this guy would do?
Oh, by the way, I think what? We already have to assess some points. Because guess what?
Guess his name's what, not Carlos Mencia, is it?
You knew that, didn't you?
How'd I did.
You know? Do you know what his real name is?
Yes, I do, actually. Because I watched Joe Rogan's takedown of him. His name is Ned beautiful. Holness.
Yep.
Am I wrong?
I think his actual last name has been Sia, but yeah.
So he's like got a German name or whatever the fuck. So even the whole like I'm a meaner, eh? All that stupid shit he put on it's all just bullshit.
So his real name is Ned.
It's Ned.
Yeah. So
like Ned fucking Flanders, dude. You know what? Just go ahead and give him one for that, dude.
So you got plus one just for being Ned
Mencia. Come on.
I mean, easy. That's an easy plus one.
Your name sucks. You get a point just for that. Just for that.
You know what he fucking reminds me of? It's kind of guy if you dropped, like, say you dropped $10 in front of me, pick it up and be like, oh, dude, that's my money. No, man.
No,
man. I didn't see that.
I found it, eh? Finders, keepers, losers, weepers. What a piece of shit.
He sucks.
You're right about that, too. He would totally do that.
Oh, he would take it.
Take it in a fucking second, dude.
Finders, keepers,
He'd grab it before he'd hit offended. The ground, dude.
He'd catch it in midair. He'd
catch it mid-fucking-fall, dude.
Hey, man, it's mine. It up. Hey, you dropped it, man. It's not my fault.
You dropped it, eh? You know? He was born in San Pedro Sula, Honduras. He was the 17th of 18 children.
Holy fucking shit. His daddy was busy.
So no wonder there's no childhood pictures of him. By the time they had him, they were over it. They're like, another fucking kid.
All right.
He has classic 17th child syndrome.
Yeah, you know how that goes, man.
His mother, Magdalena Mencia, was Mexican. His father, Roberto Holness, was Honduran. At the time of his birth, Mencia's mother was engaged in a domestic dispute with his father and declined to give her son his biological father's last name. So he's not named after his father. The name appearing on his birth certificate is Ned Arnell Mencia.
Ned, dude. Oh, my God. Of course he's a Ned.
Hi, I'm Ned Arnell. Mencia. Although Mencia has said, out of respect for his biological father, he went by the Holness name anyway and was known as Ned Holness until he was 18 years old. So that's where you got that impression.
Okay.
His actual birth certificate name, Ned Arnell Mencia. He was raised Roman Catholic in East Los Angeles.
What a shock.
By his aunt, Consuelo. Not even Consuela, but Consuelo. All right. And uncle, Pablo Mencia.
Oh, my God, dude. They have such stereotypical Spanish names.
By his own admission, staying out of trouble was difficult while growing up. But with the help of his family, he excelled in school and stayed out of gangs. He attended Garfield High School in Los Angeles County. Mencia dealt drugs when he was 19 years old and burglarized a house. He majored in electrical engineering at California State University of Los Angeles, but left early to pursue a career in comedy after a successful performance at an open mic night at the Laugh Factory. He has an older brother named Joseph Mencia, who often appeared on Mind of Mencia. That was his big show back in the fucking day. So the first category we're going to take a look at is his stand-up, because why the fuck not? I got a few different instances of his stand-up. This is Carlos Mencia's stand-up from 1998.
So really early.
So yeah, pretty early stand-up. Let's take a quick look at that.
Wow, he looks like Chris Kattan getting arrested.
Show him, Carlos. It's Carlos Mencia.
Carlos Mencia.
Hey, y'all. How are you doing tonight?
Doing all right, Carlos Mencia. How are you?
Thank you for letting me come into your country without giving me too much hassle about crossing the border.
And I want to thank the band for not playing La Bamba for the Mexican. Appreciate that very much. Stereotypes. Hey, they're cool, though. I don't get mad at them. You know, people don't want to laugh at stereotypes, which is wrong. You know what I mean? It's not even cool, man. Nobody wants to laugh at themselves anymore. I swear to God, America's so PC, politically correct.
Yeah.
I can't even do a black joke in America anymore, you know?
Oh, he's right about that. Yeah, man. No, that's funny, man.
Oh, when, God, dude. I can imagine every dude, bro, like, man, he's got, like, a point, dude.
There's, like, a point to this, man. He's like,
bro.
Yeah.
Like, he just can't tell it like it is.
Instead of
like,
making it, you know, instead of saying something funny, he just talks about how he can't say something funny because America too uptight, man. Yeah, man, it's so true, too. Can't talk about nothing no more. This is a 98, you know? I mean, you could get away with a lot fucking more. Oh, yeah.
People go, are they here? We need a black guy in the front row. It's okay. I'm not offended. Go ahead. Laugh it up. Laugh it up.
No one, I mean, you can give them all the permission you want to laugh at your antics. They're, you know, it's still not. Wow.
You gotta learn to laugh at yourself, you know? I laugh at myself all the time.
You should.
I'm watching Carlos Mencia.
Hell, I come from a freaky family. I mean, you know, stereotypes are endorsed in my family. You know what I mean? When they talk about a whole bunch of Mexicans in one car, that was my family right there, folks. I have 11 sisters and six.
I mean, no, because your father was from Honduras. So, no.
His mom's Mexican.
That's close enough,
six
I guess.
Six brothers. Yeah, my mom's a uterus with a head. That's my mom. This lady had babies to the conga.
I mean, that is true. He was the 17th of 18 children, so I guess, yep. What's nothing particularly funny about that? It's actually kind of tragic. Yep. Especially if they're all like him, you know? Somewhere that a woman that was churning out children like Carlos Mencia was allowed to do it until she had 18 children. Yep.
Dun, 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 dun. I swear to God.
What's wrong with these people in these audience? They're all dead inside. Okay.
I'm not making fun of
Paul. They're just dead inside.
Paul's like, eh, they're dead inside.
They're dead inside, dude. Hey, look, I recognize it.
Nothing you can do. Yeah, someone said, where's Kanye West to with a bat to bash his head in? I don't know, but that needs to happen. Thank God South Park depicted that.
Kanye, but no!
16 kids went through my mother's birth canal before I did with no C-sections. Right? I'm not saying she was loose or anything. By the time I got there, it was a slip and slide. You understand me? For the last
like, why do you care how tight your mom's pussy is?
Yeah,
bro?
I'm trying to figure that one out. I'm like, did it?
Like, man, how do you make a joke about how tight your mom's pussy is without sounding like a dude that actually sat down and thought about how tight his mom's pussy must be?
How tight was it? My daddy was all up in it. I mean, you know, he got a small little pecker.
Hey, you remember that time George Carlin went on that long riff about how tight his mom's pussy was, TJ?
Oh, classic Carlin, dude. Bit. Classic yeah. Carlin.
I was in there. I was holding on.
Sorry your mom's pussy was loose, Carlos. Or should I say Ned?
She didn't even know when I was born.
Ned's mama got a loose. That's because pussy. Who would the fuck notice you, dude? Yeah, even his mom didn't think it was worth noting. It's not because her pussy was so loose that you fell out and she didn't notice. It's because who would notice you? Of course your mother didn't see you come out of her. She didn't care about you. Who could? Look at you. Looks like a chimp. Look at him. Yeah, they should have, Are you sure Chris Kattan's little monkey character wasn't just Carlos Mencia? Yeah, maybe they switched off. Separated at birth, question mark? Ugh. God, I don't even want to press play again.
She was washing dishes. You. I'm hanging from the cord like a piñata.
A piñata. All right,
so let's look at some more recent stand-up comedy.
Like a piñata.
Piñata. It's funny because I'm Mexican.
I'm hanging from the pinche cord like a piñata. Dios mío.
It's like chicks. I always want to blame all their fucking problems on men. It's never their fault. It's never your fault that you can't come.
Definitely fatter now.
It's not fucking possible that you couldn't
now,
fucking come.
This is during his
fatter
period.
He didn't make me come, Jennifer. He didn't make me come. No, bitch, let's get this shit straight. You didn't make you come.
Why is it that we never have a problem coming, no matter how fucking ugly you are? You could be fat, ugly, we don't fucking care. We will come because we focus. When we're fucking you, and that's all we're thinking about. See, the problem with you chicks is that you don't fucking think about...
So basically, he explains why he's going to be a lousy lay for the misfortunate... the unfortunate women that want to sleep with him.
Whoever's dumb and unfortunate enough to be a groupie of Carlos Mencia. This is his early letdown.
Yeah. Look, just watch this bit I did. All right. I'll be back in about 5 minutes.
All right. So that's just looking at his raw stand-up on its own.
Raw.
We're not done with the stand-up section because there's actually more to talk about here. But I think that's enough of his actual stand-up. So where did Chris Kattan come in at?
I don't remember.
Stand up fucking 15. So Carlos Mencia, he's not quite as bad. Maybe he deserves 14.
14,
dude.
Okay.
14. Oh, my brain hurts, dude.
14 for Ned Holness.
Yeah, we didn't even look how far. I mean, we didn't even get very far into this. I mean,
Neddy Holness gets 14.
I mean, this is like a fucking 4-minute video. We're not even a fourth way. I swear we've been watching it for 2 minutes.
If that.
I mean, we watched it for 37 seconds. It felt like a fucking guy. It felt like 2 minutes at least. Holy shit. Anyway, so Carlos Mencia, often called Carlos Menstelia.
I wonder why.
And the reason is he tends to steal liberally from other people's acts. Here's an example.
Yeah, just outright gank.
Somebody else makes it.
So here's Sam Kinison doing a bit.
No wife would ever buy the fucking resurrection, all right? It's like, sure. She sees him on Friday afternoon. He takes off with 12 fucking guys. She doesn't hear from him again till Monday. He comes in the house. She's going, and where have you been for 3 days, Mr. Winemaker? Jesus is going, no, I'll tell you where I've been. Sure. First of all, not that it's important, but I was bad! I'm in a fucking grave outside of town! I'm fighting death, hell, decomposure! I'm changing spiritual form, I'm about to come into the kingdom of God, and I go, wait a second! I better go back because she doesn't know where I've been! Yeah, it never would have worked, man. Been all kinds of press. Jesus gets divorced, wife doesn't buy resurrection, you know?
So that was the Sam Kinison bit. This is a clip from Mind of Mencia.
Where the hell have you been? You've been gone for like 3 days!
You're unbelievable, Mary! They put a crown of thorns on my head! Then they nailed me to the cross. Look at that! Then they hit me on the hot sun till I died! Then they threw me in a cave! And what do I do as soon as I come back from the dead? See you!
You're cheating on me, aren't you?
Look at you! You're glowing!
Total fucking theft.
I mean, obviously just...
Dude, was that Timmy? Was that Timmy? That was Timmy. Did I hear a little...
So, this is... I could have pulled about a million examples of him stealing various jokes from different people. But why do that when he admits it here?
A lot of people out there are going to ask, why did they interview Carlos about this? You know, Carlos is a joke thief. Carlos steals jokes, and we know this. And listen to me. And look at me when I tell you this, with all honesty. If you think that I steal jokes, fuck yeah, you're right. Of course I fucking steal jokes. Are you out of your fucking mind? When I come to a comedy club, you better run, bitch. You better get the fuck off stage. Because if anything you say is even remotely funny, I'm going to make it mine. And all I'm going to do is say Mexican in the front. I'm like a rapper. I just sample shit and make it my own. Was that really my song? I don't know, but it sounds like mine, but it kind of sounds like somebody else's. It's a hit, bitch!
What a piece of trash. Wow. Wow, dude.
Wow, that's not even an accurate representation of what, like, hip-hop artists do when they sample something. Because they don't... when they sample something, they don't just take the whole thing and redo it, usually.
Dude, he fucking deserves a vanilla ice.
Like, they build something upon
it. I know it's a Bieber, man, but he fucking deserves a fucking vanilla ice.
That Kinnison bit, he just lifted that idea from Kinnison.
Yeah, he still deserves it.
He didn't even change it.
Well, the Joe Rogan takedown lists so many fucking comedians he stole from.
I mean, I have the Joe Rogan takedown.
Oh, yeah. And there's a bunch of people that don't even want to talk about it because, like, at that time, he was, like, a hot comedian, so they didn't want to fuck up their possible careers. But, like, you know, a lot of people know about it. It's kind of an open secret that Carlos likes to take jokes from people.
Let's take a look at Joe Rogan attacking him.
What the fuck is up with this music, Joe?
I don't know.
Yeah, I mean, this is terrible.
Just, like, mute out of that. So this is February 10th, 2007. At the Comedy Stowe. Carlos is up on stage.
I'm somebody important enough that he had to end the show by saying Carlos Mencili. That's who I am.
Yo, bro, how good is all this? If someone steals a riff from a song, that shit's in the news constantly. Yeah. Motherfuckers steal shit and make it on HBO. It better, they steal shit, they put it on television. What are you saying? Listen, I know you
guys saying that you're acting like a little bitch.
No, you're not saying that.
Yes.
Me,
they're not agreeing with you. They don't even know what the fuck I do. They don't even know what the fuck I do. They don't know shit. You just talk shit. It's easy to say you steal shit. I could say you steal shit, but I don't, because I'm not a little bitch.
Dude, we're here to prove otherwise, sir.
You have no fucking right to call anyone a little bitch, especially Joe Rogan.
Because I'm not a little bitch, unlike you, Joe Rogan, who could easily kick my fucking ass.
Fucking break you in half.
Dude, I saw a video the other day of Joe Rogan doing, like, this spin kick shit. I was like, God damn.
Yeah,
I was across the table from that motherfucker. Remember, he never pissed Joe Rogan off.
I would.
Let me tell you what I think. I think that every time you open your mouth, you talk about me. I think that you're secretly in love with me because you can't shut the fuck about me. That's what I personally fucking think. You always open your fucking mouth about me.
Yeah, give him a fucking mic.
You always say what the fuck you want about me. Never shut the fuck up. You never shut the fuck up. That's not for you. That's not for you.
This is for someone who creates their own shit.
That's not for you.
Yeah, you see that? You hear that cheering? This is cheers for someone who creates their own shit.
Those are cheerless motherfuckers. They saw you perform and they like you. And you know what? That's great.
I'm honest, bro.
I like how they put Carlos in quotation marks. They're like, you ain't even Carlos, bitch. You're Ned, and we know it.
Oh, yeah. Yes, he knows.
Go ahead. Tell everybody.
You steal material.
What material? What material?
You always been verbatim about
wait a minute. Oh, you mean the bit that either George Lopez did when he just did that fucking show?
Did it a long time ago when he was opening for you. You saw him do it.
When the fuck did he open for you? He never opened for me.
Dude, I opened for you and did that joke in the rooms you performed in.
So the dude was just happened to be there.
Yeah.
Ari Shaffir just happened to be there that night. He's like, yeah, dude, you stole my joke.
Well, that joke before.
No, you weren't.
Yes, bro.
Absolutely not.
Wow, dude. Here's this new thing. I don't know if you guys heard this. He wants to build a new wall all down the California-Mexico border. Like a 12-foot-high brick wall. It's like 3 feet deep. So no Mexicans get in. But I'm like, dude, Arnold, who do you think is going to build that wall?
I propose that we kick all the illegal aliens out of this country. Then we build a super fence so they can't get back in. And I went, who's going to build it?
That's the fucking joke.
Womp, 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 womp.
I mean, that's pretty obvious.
I mean, he stole the joke.
Do you really think that a Jewish guy came up with that joke before a fucking
You really think a Jewish guy came up with that before my pretending to be Mexican ass did?
Before a beaner?
Before Ned came up with it?
Do you think he came up with it? Yes, I do.
I think your new show needs to be called Mind of Ned.
Do you really believe that shit?
So how many
do you believe
more?
It? Yes, it's true.
I mean, this just goes on with him being destroyed in every conceivable way.
I can see. I mean, obviously, this has the benefit of being edited, but I mean, I'm sure at the time it's just him going, oh, this guy's just lying. They're just making up shit about me.
They just keep catching him in lie after lie after lie after lie. So he's a joke thieving piece of shit, and he's brazen about it. How many more points do we add to
that? Oh, for that, dude, he gets another fucking 10. Dude.
Yeah, 10.
So 24.
I mean,
making an even 25.
I mean, just being an unoriginal fucking joke thief. I mean, so blatant and being called out, then just denying it. I mean, even literally bringing up one of the people whose jokes he stole.
Make it a nice, pleasing 25.
25 points.
Fuck this dude.
10 more points than Chris Kattan. What a turd. In the stand-up section. Holy shit. That's crazy. Come on, Bieber. There you go. So beautiful. So fucking beautiful. All right, so TV work. Not a whole lot.
Other than, you know,
I mean, like,
the Mind.
Yeah, Mind of Mencia, which that'll be discussed later. I mean, it's going to be a crowning fucking achievement.
Right. What else could be?
Other than that, not a whole lot of shit. There's a few things. Most of it was just him doing his stand up, which we've already appraised. Very few, he's appeared like 60, 70 times as himself in things. Very rarely does he actually act, quote unquote. Here's an example from the Bernie Mac show. I'm going to have to kind of skip to like 1440 or so to see him. And even then, not a whole lot to it. It's just sort of like generic best.
Rest in peace, Bernie.
Yeah, he's just one of the guys playing cards. There he is. Oh, that's wrong.
Oh man, he's very believable.
You could ask me. I got a couple I ain't using.
Why is he talking like a black dude?
Real funny.
Because he's on a black show, dude.
But, like, isn't he supposed
someone
to be
said
Mexican?
Rogan was dropped by his agent because of him attacking Carlos Mencia.
I don't doubt it.
Well, that's a useless agent. Fuck him.
Yeah. It's a favor.
You pet a dog, you get your ass bit. Yes?
I mean, you've seen the extent of what he does in this. He sits at that table and goes, ah, yeah.
And talks like a black dude. Even though he's like the Mexican friend of the group.
Yeah. I don't want to play too much of it, you know.
Right.
I don't know what the copyright shit is on it, but.
He doesn't contribute anything to the show.
I mean, he's just generic best friend guy. He can't actually play a fucking character. He's just useless. Here he is doing some voice work for the Proud Family. He plays Felix.
Proud Senator.
George Foreman. Hey, champ. Could you sign my belly?
Ooh. And I thought I was out of shape.
Excuse me, champ. Felix, he's a judge. What are you doing, man?
That's it. I mean, that's his only line that he says in that, so.
Can you sign my belly?
Can you sign my belly? Can you sign my belly? I mean, he's been in a few other shows. I couldn't find him in them. I looked. I searched for clips.
A show I haven't heard of.
And so he was on the Bernie Mac show a couple times. And he was, I guess, a recurring fat Mexican character on The Proud Family.
A recurring embarrassment there.
And that's pretty much it. That's pretty much all I could find, other than Mind of Mencia, which...
We can't give him too many for that, but he deserves something. We can't let him go unscathed.
I agree, but there's not a lot there. I'd say 5.
Sure, yeah. It's hard to
give him
fair.
5 more. So, what about films? Is there any sort of film work he ever did?
Ever do Beaner on the Loose?
I mean, his film career, much like his television career, very limited. Probably his most famous character is from a movie called, Heartbreak Kid with Ben Stiller, failed Ben Stiller movie, where he played a character called Uncle Tito. Here's that.
Wow.
Punks.
Hold on.
Hola, senor. Hey, do you think you could tell me where I could find Uncle Tito?
Yes, may I ask who is inquiring?
Yeah, my name's Eddie Cantro, and I'm a friend of his. I'm supposed to give him something.
I'm sorry to tell you this, but he no longer works here. He's actually in jail serving 6 to 10 years.
he was caught running cockfights, and I'm not speaking about the kind with roosters.
Really?
Screw off! I'm joking, man! Come on! I am Uncle Tito!
Ho-ho!
Wow.
That's so funny.
What a breakout character.
And I mean, this goes on for 4 minutes and 50 seconds. I don't know how wise it would be to try to play too much of this either. Not,
but yeah, we see. I've seen it.
But,
enough.
You know, it's this. That's what he plays. Here's another one. Low-budget movie. It just has a bunch of comics doing voiceovers of penguins. Here you
the
go.
The hope is that after this detour, they'd be able to find...
It's called Farce of the Penguins.
But it's too late for some.
Here you
Treacherous
go.
Journey has already affected their minds.
I don't need the rest of those fuckers. I have found good Antarctic skunkweed. And that skunkweed will help me find the treasure of Sierra Madre. It is I, and I alone, Juan Sanchez, who will make this discovery. And then I will be famous.
Wow.
Please just kill with fire.
Oh my god, man. I just want to dunk my head in the toilet.
Fuck it.
The Sierra Madre, the treasure! Oh my god. Why? Why? Just wretchedly awful.
I mean, I just want to... let me just show you guys what I'm talking about here. Like, so you could fucking kind of experience this just joy here.
I don't want to experience any more, TJ.
Here you go. Let me just show you
what I'm talking
about. No more. This is the IMDb page here. Actor, 14 credits. Self, 51 credits. And I mean, most of this acting shit is just, you can't find it. Like, you can't find Miguel Ramirez from Our Family Wedding. That ain't a fuck. No one gives a shit. No one gives a shit.
La Chamba.
He's in the Drawn Together TV series. It's a bunch of his proud family shit. Like, a lot of voice work. I guess he played someone named Gabbo on The Shield. Try to find that. Eh.
Nothing.
You know, so, like, as far as film and television work goes, not much. I would say this film work is even more embarrassing than this television work, but like I said, not much of it, so you can't really give him too much fucking shit over it, I guess. At least he makes himself scarce.
The much of the pain.
So I don't know. I'd say another, like, 7.
Sure.
Yeah.
Give him 7.
For his films. For his films.
Is that what these are?
Yep.
Films.
Very limited film work. So probably his most famous achievement is his show, Mind of Mencia. You can see here it has a 3.1 on IMDb. Pretty impressive. Unfortunately, copyright on the clips from the show are enforced very rigidly because it's Viacom. And either that or just no one cares to upload them to YouTube. Because if you search Mind of Mencia, you find endless Carlos Mencia stand-up. You don't find shit from this show except for, like, really shitty filming the TV with a fucking camcorder kind
of
shit.
There was one of those shows that in its time was like, people were like, yeah, I love this show, but no one gave a fuck about it.
I don't think anybody has nostalgic feelings about Mind of Mencia.
No.
Mind of Mencia.
And look when it ended. I mean, it started in 2006 or 2005, and it ended right around the time. I mean, it didn't last much longer after the Joe Rogan shit. Like, it was just like, everyone at that point knew, like, hey, this guy's kind of just a fucking joke. He's a fraud. You know, yeah, he just steals other people's shit. He has nothing original to say.
He's total ass. I mean, he's just unwatchable dog shit. I hate him so fucking much. But yeah, that's pretty much his crowning fucking achievement is the Mind of Mencia. I couldn't even find a fucking episode guide on this, like, other than, like, the sites that have to do it, like this one. Wikipedia doesn't even have an episode guide, and there's, like, no fan episode guides out there. There's almost no one talking about this show. It's almost like it never fucking existed. Look, they didn't even bother to say when it ended here.
2005 to who cares?
You know, no one gives
it
a
ended
shit.
In 2008, just for the record. It's not still going. I guess there were 64 episodes of it. I remember how it went. I mean, every episode pretty much started with Carlos Mencia coming on and doing about 5 minutes of, like, hackneyed stand-up that might have been edgy in the 80s.
Yeah, maybe.
Was dog shit by the 2000s.
Just, like, race stuff.
Yeah, you know, like
observational racial
Asian
humor.
People got slanty eyes, Holmes. Oh, no, whoa, you know? And it's like, all right, yeah, hard target there.
Carlos Mencia speaking his mind and taking no prisoners.
So,
enter the mind of Mencia and get ready for a merciless mix-up of close stand-up. I mean, stand-up,
it's just an ass of
unconventional
a show.
Street interviews and shocking commercial parodies.
I'd say I don't know, if Chris Kattan got a 5 for his crowning achievement, I think Carlos Mencia deserves the same 5.
Sure.
Give it to him, dude.
For this nonsense.
This fucking dog shit.
And then, where is he now? I think the real question is, where was he ever? But, I don't know. Here he is. Oh, but here he is as a. I think this is the fattest I could find him here, by the
way. Damn, dude.
He's chunked up a little
bit. This is him at his fucking fattest. Now, he's not like this anymore. He's actually lost some weight. He now looks, let's see if I can find a modern picture of him here. Yeah, there he is.
Whoa.
So he's lost a shit ton of weight right there, as you can see. But a brief history of the rise and fall of Carlos Mencia. Now, we already talked about a lot of this, like his joke theft, his doubling down on joke theft. I don't care about his insensitive Katrina remarks. Widely hated in the comedy community, yeah. Weight loss. Now, this is the part that I was like, what?
No, dude.
He may bring back Mind of Mencia or something like it.
If he can find a way to get some leverage on some Comedy Central executives, maybe.
Yeah, do you have any naked pictures of Comedy Central chairman of the board or anything? Though he has shied away from television work for some time. I don't think that's what it is. Mencia may not have one but two television shows in the works. Please, God, no. Mencia claims the first could be a dark, edgy half-hour program. I don't want to see Carlos Mencia's idea of dark and edgy, please. The second show he briefly discussed would be in the same vein as Mind of Mencia. By the way, has there ever been a show like named after something that doesn't exist more than that?
Yeah. No.
The show would tackle current events, presumably using his social commentary as a starting point.
Oh, no, is that what he does? Yeah. Social commentary.
No networks or partnerships were mentioned in picking up either of the projects.
Yeah, no shit.
And they won't be.
And guess what? He's a competitor of ours, guys.
Fuck, dude.
Oh, shit.
He is my competitor.
Yeah, as of fucking 5 months ago, he's a podcast.
Dude, have you heard any of his shit?
Let's see. Maybe we can listen to it now. Let's see what he does.
See what it sounds like.
Carlos Mencia podcast. Let's listen on iTunes or whatever. Yeah, he's done 15 episodes of it so far, and it seems like he actually stopped in... Oh, wait, no, that's later. Let's see. So, no, that's episode one. No, that he didn't stop.
That's his most
recent. So, he did it for about a year. It looks like he's pretty much quit. Or actually, it looks like it's been pretty sporadic. So he's only done 15 episodes.
It's called The Journey?
The Journey by Carlos Mencia. Garbage. Okay. So that's what he's... And then comedian draws on heritage for laughs.
Journey did he make? The journey from fat fake Mexican comic to skinny fake Mexican comic.
This is the Fayetteville Observer.
So this is just a local paper writing about how he draws on his heritage to be quote-unquote funny. And there's an interview with him, and it's horrible. And basically, I mean, like, he's just out there doing stand-up. He has a net worth of $35 million somehow, probably just mostly from his past. But he ain't doing shit. He tours. He talks about how maybe he'll have a TV show again someday. He probably won't. Even if he does, it'll probably flop.
If there's a God in heaven, he won't.
I mean,
means he probably will.
He's a has-been at this point. Everything else is just pipe dreams.
So, I mean, like, he's pretty much a total has-been. He just does some stand-up. I mean, he doesn't have anything, like, there's no DUI. He was caught with an underage prostitute and 10 pounds of cocaine or anything. There's nothing fascinating.
Actually, that'd be kind of interesting if that happened.
That's what I'm saying. There's nothing really interesting about it. Like, when I did Carlos Mencia, when I was done doing the research, I'm almost like, instead of the biggest little bitch, it should have been who's the biggest fucking bore on the face of the planet.
The biggest bland bitch, dude.
The blandest little faggot
ever. He really is just
Carlos Mencia.
A special flavor of bland. It's like you put it in your mouth and you just get no taste. You just spit them out. You just go, what is this?
I propose a score of 10 for his banal, where is he now?
The least he could do is have a sex scandal or a DUI or something.
A mental breakdown, you know, a divorce, something.
I mean, that's just awful.
37. Okay. So 42, 52. He puts him in a score of 52.
Oh, good for him.
Oh, no, 53 because of the point we added. So not even close to Chris Kattan's score.
I mean, a little bitch, certainly, a contender in his own right, but...
Yeah, he certainly deserved to be thought of in this little bitch competition, but cannot usurp Chris Kattan.
I mean, who can at this point? Maybe perhaps only one man.
One,
the inimitable,
quote, man.
The unstoppable, the unsufferable Will Wheaton.
Will
Wheaton! Or as we like to call him, Wesley.
Shut up, Wesley. You fucking doddering imbecile.
So, Will Wheaton, and this is pulled directly from Encyclopedia Dramatica, because this is actually the summary I like the best about him. Will Wheaton is a D-list celebrity who's infamous for his role as the most hated Star Trek character of all time. Because of this, and the fact that he has regularly appeared on the TV show The Big Bang Theory, and he considers himself to be some kind of icon for nerd culture... He is also an insufferable SJW shitbag and is married to a single mom, making him the literal definition of a cuck.
Wow.
Like most attention-whoring male feminists these days, he spends most of his time using Twitter as a mouthpiece to apologize for his male privilege and white guilt, while ironically getting away with harassing women because he is incredibly easy to troll. This results in much hilarity. And I mean, he is a... You know what? He is a little butthurt bitch. I mean, the most astonishing thing about Will Wheaton is how butthurt he gets.
You know what? Can we give him a fucking... Can we give him one for his punchable fucking face?
Oh, God, dude, yes. Let's go ahead and give him one for that.
Because, God, man, he's got... We might even have to give him more later, but, like, just in this picture, man, he's so punchable. Don't you just want to sock him?
Dude.
We went to the Star Trek convention in, like, 2015. Most people out there fans of merchandise. Everything for Will Wheaton was Shut Up, Wesley. I mean, there's so many t-shirts, and I'm like, this shirt looks interesting. And people are like, yeah, it's a hot seller right there.
Shut up, Wesley.
Shut the fuck up, Wesley!
So, Richard William Wheaton III, he's got one of those names, was born on July 29th in 1972 in Burbank, California. His father, Richard William Jr., a medical technician, and his mother, Deborah O'Connor, an actress, subsequently provided their eldest son, whom they called Will... with a younger brother and sister. Will Wheaton's acting career began early at the age of 7 when he made his first appearance on a television commercial, and this was actually for Pudding Pops, the Jell-O Pudding Pops with comedian Bill Cosby.
Oh.
And I tried to find this. If I saw him in a commercial, he was not recognizable. Luckily for him, he wasn't a woman, because otherwise those Pudding Pops would have come with a little some extra. His actual first big break is voicing the character of Martin in The Secret of Nim. Obviously, I didn't want to pull that because I just was too worried about copyright.
Right. But it's not a bad movie.
It's not actually a bad movie. I mean, that has much to do with Will Wheaton, but whatever.
Right.
So his breakout role was The Stand By Me.
I mean, it might be his only good role, really, genuinely. It,
just as long
but we're gonna get as that, you stand. We're going to get that stand by in me. Film. And I pulled the scene for that. Like I said, we're going to get to that when we do the film. So instead of doing stand-up, we're going to do with Will.
We're going to do his Twitter, right?
Yeah, I mean, we'll get a little bit more into his bio real quick.
Because obviously he doesn't do stand-up, so...
No, he doesn't. So he did Stand By Me, pretty decent flick. In the years following the release of Stand By Me, Wheaton would find work in countless other films and television series, including Saint Elsewhere, Family Ties, and Tales from the Crypt. When they say that, that's being very generous, like he had bit parts. Tales from the Crypt, he was in one episode.
Well, yeah, you know, most people didn't.
Family Ties, I mean, it just, he didn't have, I mean, it just wasn't much to that stuff, and I couldn't find anything for it. However, his most high-profile appearance was as Wesley Crusher on the Star Trek series The Next Generation.
High-profile?
That was his,
yeah. I mean, I guess the show was high-profile, but God, man, everybody hated him.
Which starred Patrick Stewart, yes, I agreed. Wheaton, an admitted fan of the original Star Trek series and self-identified geek, relished his role in the show. Fans, however, did not. After enduring their criticism for several years, Wheaton chose not to appear regularly on the after the fourth season.
Good.
This isn't
bullshit.
My flea circus.
I call bullshit.
This isn't my Star Trek.
Nothing to do with that. The real story is this: Gene Roddenberry made fucking Will Wheaton's character Wesley Crusher into a Mary Sue. Gene Roddenberry passed away after the end of about the third season of Star Trek. So guess who gets ridden off the show at around the same time?
Right. So Gene had the great big boner for this character because he saw himself.
So basically, no one could say no to Gene. This is kind of his like, okay, Gene, we'll put Wesley on the show. And I mean, Gene Roddenberry actually famously said at just one of the Star Trek conventions, what was it, that if you hate Wesley Crusher, then you hate me.
Right. So he's just like admitting there that he just wrote himself into the show.
Yeah, it's his Mary Sue. So, you know, after the Next Generation, things don't really get too good for Will. I mean, he tries his damnedest. He fucking tries his little heart out. Although Wheaton's Star Trek character drew a vocal anti-fan following from the Trekkies, his subsequent online presence of his website, willwheaton.net, which he proudly maintains and codes himself, has made him a sort of unofficial spokesperson for the geek-slash-nerd community.
No.
Willwheaton.net.
Yeah, so Will Wheaton has clearly written this article about himself, his convention appearances, blogging, podcasts, enthusiastic computer gaming, and even his stint as a tech developer for Video Toaster 4000, which involved a move to Kansas, has further underscored Wheaton's professional geek status. In 2009, Forbes named him among the most influential web celebrities.
No.
And his Twitter account now boasts upwards of 3 million followers.
What the fuck, man? There's no justice
it's
in the
just
world anymore.
It's just a bunch of fucking horse shit about how his mainly failed projects are just doing great.
I don't like it.
So let's go to social media.
All right, so instead of stand-up, we're going to do social media for Will Wheaton.
So the first one I have, or I don't know what order TJ put. We're going with Twitter first? Okay.
Oh, well, what else is there?
Well, I have the YouTube videos of him as well.
Oh, okay. Well, yeah, we'll look at those
dog
as well.
Shit.
Twitter's board of directors.
So this is a big theme in his life right now, which is that they're not doing enough to crack down on Twitter.
Twitter's board of directors needs to remove Jack from his position.
Let's talk about the CEO of Twitter.
Jack's refusal to address the rampant systemic problems Twitter has with Nazis and other violent individuals is very real and very dangerous threat to every person who lives in a place that Twitter reaches. All right.
Yeah, makes total sense to me. I mean, that is the problem right now. Twitter is not being policed enough.
Yeah. By the way, I had to log out of Twitter to see these tweets.
Oh, yeah, you are definitely blocked. Let's put it this way. You're definitely blocked by Will Wheaton.
And chances are, if you're watching this, you're blocked too.
Yeah, he employs blocklist heavily and brags about it.
He's almost as bad as Shives
method. Yeah.
Oh, dude, if there's anyone that's worse than Steve Shives, it's Will Wheaton, dude.
Do you wonder if Shives learned from Will Wheaton?
Will he this account did. Mocks fascist Wheaton? What a hardcore motherfucker, dude.
He also despises TJ, which is pretty great.
Good.
I mean, yeah, that's a fucking badge of honor.
2 days ago, a Nazi propagandist called for his followers to murder journalists. He's talking about Milo Yiannopoulos there, by the way.
Milo Yiannopoulos is a Nazi propagandist who called for the murder of journalists.
For 2 years, the president has repeatedly attacked the press as an enemy of the people. Watch our episode on the Satanic Panic and tell me otherwise, you fucking bitch. Today, a gunman murdered 5 people in a newsroom. These events are all connected.
So he's basically putting the murder at the feet.
He's got those. He's got that room with like all the newspaper clippings taped to the wall and the yarn leading from one to the next, wrapped around fucking
the Nazis
and shit.
Malianopoulos and Trump all responsible.
Jesus, what has the world become?
I mean, dude, his Twitter account is filled with gold. Like
20,000 likes, dude. 20,000 likes. Hi, nerds.
This isn't promoting his short stories or books.
Some self-promotion because I'm terrible at it and I don't
do
it nearly
enough.
Oh, dude,
he always cloaks all his self-promotion, his shilling and shit like this. Like, I'm really bad at this, but please buy my shit.
I'm really proud of this story I wrote and I want you to know about it. It's called Dead Trees Give No Shelter.
I'm sure it's riveting.
Wow, that sounds fucking like
and
a
he's made barely 40
can
sales.
Can you read us a little excerpt from Dead Trees Give No Shelter? Come on, Teej.
I don't even know if I... is it?
You have to pay for it, but there might be a free preview.
There's got to be at least a quote.
Where is it? Dead tree. Where is it? Kindle for $3. What?
Oh, never mind.
Maybe I can find like.
There's usually a little fucking preview.
A little excerpt of something. There's like a preview. Look inside. All right.
Oh, shit.
Oh, shit, dude.
Kenneth Blake strained his eyes, looking past his own reflection toward the room of witnesses on the other side of the one-way glass. He hoped that Jay Turner was in that room, hoped that Jay was there to hear him speak one last time. Walter Davis looked at the phone on the wall.
Oh, my God, this is insipid, dude.
It had rung only once
expository
in the 26 years he'd been warden, and it would not ring tonight.
Oh, God, this
Kenneth
is awful.
Blake was as guilty as any prisoner who had strapped to the gurney, and no government, re-election campaign or not, was going to pardon a child killer.
What the fuck?
He checked his watch against the digital clock on the wall above the phone. It was time. All right. Yeah, okay.
Time for what?
Time for the execution.
Pap. Fucking rent
time for the execution
midget.
Of your brain cells.
I mean,
Walter
me,
Davis looked at his watch. You know, what is this fucking just like
right, check this out,
shit
though.
Writing?
Here's my Kindle publisher's report for the last 90 days. The two sparks are days I promoted.
Spikes.
Even then, it's barely 40 sales.
Dude, Will Wheaton, you should be happy.
I can't imagine how
this
hard this is
shit.
For someone without my reach. This is his book sales, dude.
And he has 3 million plus followers.
Wait a minute. I think I see something.
Beep.
Is there something there?
Beep.
I don't know.
Boop.
About three quarters of the way down, it looks like there might be a faint line. Is that a thing?
Yeah, right here.
Oh,
here.
Yeah, there it is.
There's the two lines.
Look at that.
There's a few little blips here, like he sold one.
Looks like a brain dead patient's EKG.
Why would you share this yourself, dude? I can't imagine how hard this is for someone without my reach. Yeah, well, it's easier for someone who actually has writing talent.
40
you know?
Sales, wow.
And this is a depressing theme in his life. Like, he bounces from thing to thing hoping he's going to have a hit. That's kind of his thing.
Let's see.
40 sales, dude.
Robert Barnes. Justice Kennedy, the pivotal swing draw on the Supreme Court, announces retirement. We had a good run, America. Get ready for a generation of regressive corporate nationalist rule. Great work, Bernie bros. Glad you didn't think there was a meaningful difference between Hillary Clinton and Donald Trump. Bravo. Yeah, it's Bernie
it's
Bros.
It's Bernie
fault.
Bros that
oh,
caused
yeah, blame
it.
The Bernie Bros. Yeah, they're definitely at
not,
fault
not,
for this.
Not the people that supported Trump, the Bernie Bros.
Yeah, dude.
Who definitely wanted the policies that Trump is implementing.
Oh, and definitely
idiot.
Not the Hillary shills that kept ramming her down our throat even though nobody wanted her.
Hillary
nope.
in the house.
They got
Hillary in the White House. Yeah. Someone who was actually a fucking progressive. It was his fault we got Donald Trump. Fuck you.
Oh, clearly. Clearly.
What a twat. What a twat, what a twat, what a twat. It's been at least 5 hours since one of the big papers or cable networks ran a soft-focus normalization of Trump's fascist base. I hope everyone's okay at the Post and the Times and CNN and that this is just an oversight. Oh, my God.
I mean, whatever.
I mean, how fucking insufferable can you be?
Batman, quick, to the virtue signal.
Dude, scroll down. Let's see the fucking reply. Never normalize Trump, dude.
Whatever.
What a joke.
I'm shocked, and I'm sure you'll understand that before I'm ready to make a public statement about my best friend to 3 million-plus people, I need time to process what's going on and put words to my thoughts. Thanks for listening and understanding.
Chris Hardwick. I thought it was just interesting because it's like he's this big time SJW feminist, and it's like, dude, wouldn't you just come out and say she should be believed and instantly condemn him? Like, why would you need time to process it?
Yeah, you'd think.
Shouldn't all these women be believed, Will?
All of them.
So just his hypocrisy on display yet again.
Once more.
My Twitter experience last week. Thank you for sharing your experiences living with mental illness. You saved my life. My Twitter experience this week. Lol, why you block this YouTuber, you faggot. Go kill yourself. Meme, meme, meme. 2018 is a real roller coaster.
I just like that because the way he actually described his experience this week. I was actually pretty proud of that. I was like, you know, or in June.
So maybe we could try to remember Twitter is fickle. With great power comes great response. You don't have great power. Shut up, idiot.
His is try not to be a dick thing that he always does, but, I mean, he's just a giant twat himself, so maybe that's why.
If you want to remove a lot of toxic garbage from your mentions and timelines, you can subscribe to my block list. Cool. Blocktogether.org.
Yeah, he employs block lists.
Let me think for you, you pieces of fucking shit. And then he goes on this rant about Nixon and shit, whatever.
He's a fucking
moron.
He's
a turd.
Dude, he's a fucking moron.
So we have some video of him, too, you said, huh?
Yeah.
Well, how much do you want to appraise for his Twitter alone?
Oh, God, his Twitter alone, dude.
It's gotta be worth at least 10 or 15. At least
13, dude. Let's just give him 13.
13 points.
You can see how insipid it is. It's all just this shit. He's just a fucking total libtard fucking idiot.
Insipid, sipid, twat.
He really is. He's just like your typical fucking brain dead Hollywood liberal. Like, look, Trump is destroying our nation. I mean, it's not even so much that, like, there's a lot of things in his political ideology that honestly make that would make sense to you if you're liberal. It's just the way he presents it is just mind-numbingly stupid.
Mm-hmm. He's kind of a twat.
There's no kind of about it.
He's kind of almost sort of a little bit of a twat.
He's a massive fucking bleeding vagina.
He's a bit of a twat, he is. All right, so he has some videos.
He does have a YouTube channel he's still active on. I mean, not regularly, but he posts some shit.
Occasionally, yeah.
He'll come up with some great stuff. He's really funny and entertaining.
He's a really funny guy?
Oh, God, yeah, dude.
Oh, okay. Let's take a look.
You're about to find out.
About to find out how fucking funny he is. All right. So let's see. What's the first one I should play?
Looking at my list, I'd say let's go with... let me see here. No, not that. Oh, social media's at my top of my list. It is... God damn, where the fuck did this go?
I mean, here's one called Hello Ladies. Here's another stupid video.
Okay, I found it. Yeah, go ahead and do that.
Hello ladies. Look at your man. Now back at me. Now to your man. Now back to me. Now be glad that your man is actually with you, not 1,000 miles away in Vancouver, where I am. Not my wife. We really miss a lot.
He's so weird.
Sorry.
He's so fucking
sorry, I just
whip.
Had to projectile vomit a little bit there.
Life's all about balance.
Blah, 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 blah.
This is another great one. This is not a burrito, John.
This is not a burrito, John.
Some great acting by Will Wheaton.
Dude, he's got Chauncey there.
Yeah, Chauncey gets
Chauncey's around. A traitor. Well, that was worth my time.
Yeah.
Wow. Truly a genius.
Bowling shirts like bow ties are cool.
Okay.
This morning, I went bowling with my sons and my father. Three.
Wait a minute. Generations of this fucking thing reproduced?
No. Those kids are not his biologically.
Oh, thank God.
He's a stepdad.
Okay.
At the bowling alley. I won the first game. I lost.
Fair enough, fair enough.
But I actually won at bowling because I got to wear this while we played. Yeah.
There is no justice in the universe. Yeah.
Oh my fucking God, dude. Why? Is there any. Please tell me there's no more YouTube videos of his. Please, please, please.
We're actually going to watch an actually popular YouTube series he does for, I think it's like Geek and Sundry.
Oh, please.
So Tabletop, and it's Will Wheaton plays Eldritch Horror. This is actually a pretty popular series he's been a part of. Yeah, we don't care. Just skip.
Use my axe as some sort of crutch?
What?
Come on. I will.
Dude.
Paul just took a massive shit. Dude, well, you know what, Paul?
The meanest shit.
I would have rather.
I'm sorry, I would dude.
Have, no. You know what, Paul?
Nature fucking called.
No,
in
Paul.
A
listen,
big way.
Listen,
it was
Paul.
Like, yo, lady.
After reading through Will Wheaton tweets and watching his YouTube videos,
yeah,
I would have rather been in there and watched you take
go
a
little
shit.
Bit earlier on because all I was just playing the fuck is just tabletop shit. So it's just them talking about the
insanity.
Game.
Insanity.
Yeah.
So go a little bit yeah. earlier on.
Earlier?
Well, you can actually have Will talking a little bit more.
Where the mystery?
Okay, here.
Where is he? Contest. Here?
So what is he doing here?
He's playing.
What did I miss while I was taking a fucking huge
in
dump?
In the location where the mystery needs to be solved, with enough clues to solve the mystery,
we could solve this mystery by the end of this turn, or we could be in a world.
Can we give him one
hurt
for his punchable face right here?
World.
At least one. I mean, you can add more for what this is. This is a really... Just look at how look at his face. Right, don't you just want to put your fist through
and
it?
This, fuck this. I want Paul to see the quality of
what did I miss when I was
video
shitting?
Here you go. You miss shit like this.
Oh my God! Punch him in the face.
My sons and my father, three generations of Wheaton at bowling alley. I won the first game. I lost the second game, but I actually won at bowling because I got to wear this while we played.
Oh my God!
Yeah.
No.
Yeah.
All right. So for his youth. For his YouTube, we already have fucking assessed multiple points for his Twitter.
He got 13 for Twitter.
For his YouTube, he deserves another 13, so 26. That's what I say.
26.
All right, sure. 26
damn
points.
Damn, dude.
He did the worst of all in the stand-up slash social media category. Baby. To the moon, man.
So he's done some TV work, eh? Most famous, probably, yeah, Wesley.
Oh, we all know.
Shit, you know?
That's going to be Wesley.
Shut up, Wesley.
I mean, he's done a lot of little bullshit things. Like, he's done a lot of voice acting shit, but it's like one episode. And it, I mean, none right, of it's
so
really
here's
worth
a Wesley
mentioning.
Clip. This is when Wesley takes over the ship.
Captain Wesley.
What about me?
What about you, bitch?
God, what about me?
Motherfuckers act like they forgot about Dre. I'm a fucking dork.
I'm a boy genius, and I'm gonna take over the Enterprise. I'll just wait for this scene, dude. It's horrible.
Recording is ordered, sir.
What?
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 I love that.
You
ordered love the delivery.
What? To the bridge, sir.
I did no such thing.
What?
I want you down in the engine room just in case we need to move out of here.
Attention, all decks, all divisions. Effective immediately, I have handed over control of this vessel to Acting Captain Wesley Crusher.
Acting Captain?
Thank you, Captain Picard. Thank you.
Oh,
and
God.
And with that order, dawns a brave new day for the Enterprise.
This is season one of Star Trek. This is a fucking terrible episode.
I mean, this would be a nightmarish scenario, though. Let's be honest.
Captain Wesley.
What if Wesley was fucking captain? How about that?
So you can see how terrible the episodes are, episodes around him were set. That they're like were centered around Wesley. They're just awful.
Captain Crusher.
So let's. Here's his fucking reign of Captain Crusher.
Incredible! How did you do that?
Hooked my model tractor beam into ship's power. Now it's a repulsor beam too. One in.
Swear to be faithful to you, Captain.
I'm so smart, you can come in.
Number one, MacDougall, get that boy out of engineering.
Get him off the show, how about?
Oh, I'm fine with
number
that.
Number one, remove him from the set.
Oh my God, dude. Blah, blah.
I mean, considering he was basically harassed and hounded off this show because he couldn't stand the criticism. I mean, this is one of my favorite TV shows, but he's one of the worst elements of the show.
He's the worst, let's be honest. Is there anything else on this show that's worse than Wesley Crusher? What would it be?
What's her name? Tasha Yar is pretty bad, too.
I mean, Wesley Crusher bad, though?
No.
I don't think so, either.
This is where Data solves the shit, because he's so fast.
See how it feels on this, Commander? I made it into a repulsor beam.
That just might work.
Just have 1 minute more, sir.
Oh, shit. A repulsor beam. Wesley, you built a repulsor beam. Save us, Wesley, please.
What if we built a repulsor beam to push that asteroid away? Using Wesley's genius mind.
Oh shit, dude, did you find it?
I left my yeah, dude, it was down on the couch. Whatever.
Here comes the couch. This is just typical shit. Wesley's always saving the fucking ship in the early seasons.
Stupid ass Wesley.
He's so precocious, yes!
Being the worst end of a great television show is a fucking serious detriment. 10.
Oh, you know what? We missed one of his YouTube videos. Hold on.
Oh, really?
God. Well, he didn't make this
okay,
one.
This is what is this? From a movie or a show?
I believe this is from a movie.
All right, well, it's not time to watch it yet then. Although, watching him fall into shit is
kind of funny. We should just replay that every time we start feeling...
Dude, this is the only reason I pulled this. I didn't find anything else about this. I just saw Will Wheaton fall into a pile of shit.
Oh, dude, that was a brilliant fucking instinct, Scotty. I needed to see that. Can we see that one more time, TJ?
Yeah, watch the full thing, too, because it's him getting picked on.
Yeah, I want to see him get picked
and
on.
And he fights back and loses.
That's great.
So it's even better. I agree with this bully, dude. There you go. You're fucking covered in shit, bitch. Just like you are.
Dude, he is shit.
You are shit. Now you're covered in it.
Dumb son of a bitch.
I want a weak little girl.
Say uncle. Say uncle, baby. Come on. Say uncle. Say it.
Give him 5 more for this. Just for whatever this is. I don't even know what it's from.
It's from... I don't even care.
I don't even
this
care,
scene
dude.
Right here.
Give him 5 more.
Yeah, all right.
Cyrus, come over here, boy. Stop picking on that little faggot Wesley.
Stop picking on that weak little sissy bitch and come on over here.
It just proves his punchable face, dude. They even knew back in the day when
he was a kid. So that was
a
movie, right? So I'll add the 5 to the film.
I'm guessing. I don't really know.
Whatever.
I just like that the fact that Wesley in a pile of shit.
Doesn't really matter where it goes.
Shut up, Wesley.
Shut the fuck up, Wesley.
I mean, besides Star Trek.
So what other shows?
Tales from the Crypt. I mean, and
you pull any of that?
I couldn't find it.
I mean, he was in Big Bang Theory. I think the fact he's in Big Bang Theory earns him another 5.
Yeah, I
think
I pulled 5 just for that.
I think I pulled some from Big Bang Theory, didn't I?
I don't see it.
Have you guys ever tried to watch Big Bang Theory?
Yeah, it's horrible.
There was one time I was in San Francisco on business, and I was staying in a shit hotel, and I had nothing to do at night when I got done with the class that I was going to, but watch shitty whatever was on network TV. And the Big Bang Theory was one of those things. And I tried to watch it like, I don't know. I watched 2 or 3 episodes of it the week or 3.
Oh, you know what?
There.
I put it under Where Is He Now? So that was just misfiled.
Oh, okay.
And he plays evil Will Wheaton on the show. That's like that's the gimmick for him. He's evil.
So just Will Wheaton then?
Well, it's like because right, he
here's
felt
what
like,
I have.
I'm too much
okay.
of a goody good.
I have acting Captain Wesley Crusher. I got that one, which we played.
I love that he thinks he's a goody good. And that there should be an evil... Dude, you are the evil Wesley Crusher, you shit.
I played the stupid bowling shirt video. I did the Hello Ladies video. Which,
Hello,
Paul,
ladies.
You're lucky you didn't see that shit.
Well, I was taking a real mean shit, TJ.
I got a couple Star Trek clips we haven't watched yet because it hasn't been time yet. I got that tabletop thing. I got the This Is Not a Burrito... Oh, here's the Big Bang Theory one. Here you go.
Will Wheaton? Will Wheaton?
Will Wheaton? Will Wheaton?
Hi, Sheldon. Here, I found this pizza flyer in your fence.
Thank you.
Okay, now you owe me a favor. Turn down the role of Professor Proton.
I don't think so.
You can't be...
So, yeah, 5 points for this.
So you know this is definitely a work of fiction because Will Wheaton was offered a starring role.
Yeah, like, when does that ever happen?
So 5 points for that alone. How much is he for being the worst character on Star Trek The Next Generation? How many points do you get for that?
He gets 10.
So that means 15.
In films, I wanted to pull Flubber, but I could literally find no clips of him from Flubber. But he's in Flubber.
So he's in Flubber, so that's worth another fucking 5 points. So that brings him up to 10 there.
Do you know what he did in Flubber?
He was the villain.
Oh my God. Right.
He was one of the
villains. I remember enough to assess points.
Yeah, he was one of the villains in the guy from was it Happy Gilmore, the guy that played like the Shooter McGavin.
So here he is in one of the Star Trek films. This is a Wesley Crusher deleted scene.
Yeah, he actually got deleted from the movie.
He was in Star Trek Nemesis. They actually took him out.
Oh,
like,
you'll see why. This is he's so terrible.
Hold up.
Oh, we can't see it.
Yeah, I know. Volume is shit.
Sort of like losing a son and gaining an empath, isn't it?
You're being a big help.
Listen, if you start tearing up, I promise I'll beam you out immediately.
Thank you.
A terrible Star Trek movie.
Captain.
Wesley, it's good to see you in uniform again.
Thank you, sir.
Suits him, doesn't it?
You looking forward to serving on the Titan?
I am very much. I have the night duty shift in engineering, and we have a double refracting warp core matrix with twin...
Wow, he looks fucking terrible.
Dude, I know. Yeah. Especially for...
He looks like he's like made up to play a vampire or something.
The strange thing is, too, is that
they play Wesley Crusher or Edward Cullen.
At the time when he was big on Star Trek, he was seen as a teen heartthrob, dude.
What? Really?
Really?
By who? Not teens.
Yeah, dude, there's like shit.
Well, he's an adult fart throb, is what he's now.
A wet fart, dude.
Would you excuse me for a moment?
Yeah.
I'll see you later.
Yeah, I'm going to excuse you forever.
Yeah,
I'm
going to award that. Permanently.
I'm going to award that. You never.
Wesley's
points.
Not going to hit on some fucking fine-ass bitch,
five
dude.
Five more for this.
Yeah, five more.
He's going to get drunk at the fucking open bar. Come on.
So that's 15.
That's shameful.
Jesus Christ. All right, Sky, what's this piece of shit's crowning achievement, dude?
I mean, unfortunately, it has to be Wesley, dude.
Wow.
Not Stand By Me, dude?
No. I mean, that movie was a big movie, but that was not the thing that defined his career. It's so clear that Star Trek really defined who he was as a person.
You're right.
You know, I mean, Stand By Me is at least
trying to find a light in the darkness.
Oh, you need to plug the Stand By Me thing.
Okay, so yeah, we need to... I don't see it. Let me just... I'll just pull it up like on YouTube.
It's actually... if you look...
No, I mean, I see it in your document. I just didn't see
it. Oh, you didn't pull it.
I don't see it in the videos I pulled. So
it's
whatever.
Leech's Stand By Me.
Yeah, I see it.
Oh, yeah, this scene.
Yeah.
Hopefully it won't play double for everybody.
I think I fixed that.
All right.
Cereal! Hopefully. Get that sleeper hold! Vern, there's something on your neck.
Yeah, right. I'm not falling for that one a chance.
No, Vern, there is something on your neck.
Like, no, for real.
Leeches!
Oh, my God!
I was terrified of leeches as a kid, so I can actually relate to this.
I told you that they were, like, supernatural, like, demons, basically.
Oh, dude, and look where fucking Will Wheaton gets a leech.
Will Wheaton gets a leech on his dick.
On his wee-wee.
Oh, no.
He gets a wee-wee leech.
Oh, no, there's a dick.
Oh,
there's
no,
a leech
Will.
On my dick. Oh, no.
Rip that leech off your dick.
That's the only time Will Wheaton's dick ever got sucked, too.
Oh, shit, man.
What a little bitch, dude. Just rip it off.
Oh, man. But then,
I don't
know. Like, it leaves... They have these raspy teeth, so it hurts to pull them off.
Ugh.
Only Will Wheaton would get a fucking leech on his dick.
Yeah, all right.
Yeah.
So he doesn't Stand By Me.
I don't want to give him any points for Stand By
whatever.
Me.
Whatever,
it's actually a good movie.
It is.
He don't exactly
he's not
make
bad
it,
in it.
Whatever.
Well, he don't make it, but he don't break it either.
He don't break it, yeah.
He fits well into the cast. I mean, obviously, the movie's carried by River Phoenix.
So here is
River Phoenix.
A scene of him as... Here's probably,
the
like...
The only good fucking episode of Star Trek I remember him
here's
being
Here's a decent turn as Wesley.
Really?
Or not.
This is when he was good as Wesley?
Yeah, this is actually returned in Season 7.
This is during his Season 7 return. Pretty decent scene, actually.
Captain.
But mostly because Patrick Stewart is selling the shit out of it.
Is it just because he's getting dressed down?
Yes.
Okay.
It's going to be fucking beautiful. So in this episode, he's part of this
Pause it. What, can you catch me up? Like, what happened in this
I mean, I can explain it while this is going on.
Why is he in trouble?
He's part of this elite fighter squadron and shit.
Actually, they kind of sum it up pretty well here.
All right.
What happens?
Okay.
Five ships crossing within 10 meters of each other and igniting their plasma trails. It's one of the most spectacular and difficult demonstrations in precision flying. And it hasn't been performed at the Academy for over 100 years. Do you know why?
It was banned by the Academy following a training accident, sir.
An accident in which all five cadets lost
their lives. Oh shit, pretty fucking dangerous.
But did he try to pull it?
You'll see.
Yeah, they tried to pull it and one of them died.
Yeah, so basically they try to pull it off.
And then they try to cover
it. So he deserves this dressing down in a big way here.
This is beautiful.
He did something real bad.
Yep.
I think that Nicholas Locarno wanted to end his academic career in a blaze of glory. And that he convinced the four of you to learn the Colvord Starburst for the commencement demonstration. If it worked, it would thrill the assembled guests. And Locarno would graduate as a living legend. Only it didn't work. And Joshua Albert paid the price. Am I correct? Cadet, I asked you a question. Am I correct?
I choose not to answer, sir.
Wrong answer, bitch.
Choose not to answer.
That was dumb.
I choose not to answer, sir.
All right, this is where they're really...
You've already given an answer to the inquiry. That answer was a lie.
I said the accident occurred after the loop. It did.
What you neglected to mention was that following the loop, your team attempted a maneuver that was the direct cause of the crash. You told the truth up to a point. But a lie of omission is still a lie.
Ain't no Fifth Amendment in the future, bitch. That's from the chat.
Your mother brought you on the bridge.
Yes, sir.
You even sat in my chair.
My chair, Wesley.
You sat in my chair.
Child playing on my ship.
And I said, shut up, Wesley.
You already knew every control, every display. You belonged on.
Still gonna suck Wesley's dick a little bit.
God, man, he looks so dressed down here. I love it.
Oh, he gets to get so much worse.
He could be an outstanding officer, and I never questioned that conviction until now.
Until now,
the first
Wesley.
Duty of every Starfleet officer is to the truth, whether it's scientific truth or historical truth or personal truth. It is the guiding principle on which Starfleet is based. If you can't find it within yourself to stand up and tell the truth about what happened, you don't deserve to wear that uniform. I'm going to make this simple for you, Mr. Crusher. Either you come forward and tell Admiral Brand what really took place, or I will.
Captain.
Dismissed!
Bitch.
Yeah, you're right. That is a good turn,
dude,
as Wesley.
This is the best fucking scene with Wesley in it.
Man, dude, you know what the great thing about that scene is? Is that Picard, he yells a little bit, but the restrained disappointment in his voice throughout is so much better than the screaming.
It is, dude.
Like, screaming is just a nice little punctuation.
This is one of my favorite scenes.
Yeah, you can just imagine Wesley must have felt like 3 inches tall by the end of that. Just absolutely dressed down by a better officer, a better man in every fucking way. That's exactly... They should have done this with Wesley in every episode. Yeah. There should have been like a little 2-minute interlude.
Yeah, Wesley, my ready room.
Like, the Picard calls Wesley into his office segment. You know, where it's just like, Wesley, I saw you at the replicators getting an extra helping. You know what I mean? And he's like, no, I didn't, sir. Wesley!
Shall I inform your mother, or shall you?
Hold on, Wesley. Let's find out the truth of this. Computer, how many helpings of pudding did Ensign Crusher have this morning? Ensign Crusher had 2 helpings of pudding. You see, Wesley? You lying weasel.
Oh, man. Good old Wesley, dude. Good old Wesley. Check this out.
Yeah, this is an episode where Q grants Wesley...
Makes him a beefcake.
Yeah,
they said that. Whoa. That's what you look like as an adult, Wesley.
wrong.
He just looks like the same kid with more wrinkles and a beard.
It's me.
I
just thought that was a beautiful picture.
Oh. No, that's great.
Yeah, I mean, as far as this moment goes.
Should we give him, like, a couple more to get... we should give him a few just for being the person... I don't know, like, they got dressed down the hardest by Picard.
Yeah, he deserves, like...
Picard did a lot of dressing down,
greatest moment... I mean, like, look, his greatest moment in cinema is pulling a leech off his dick.
Yeah.
His greatest moment in TV is... Well, getting dressed down by Patrick Stewart.
The leech dick part was great, but he did narrate the lard-ass story. Which is one of the best parts of fucking Stand By Me. So I mean, he's got his moments.
I'm going to say...
let's give him two or three.
Yeah.
For getting pooped on by Picard harder than anybody in the series. Baby, baby,
baby. Oh! Here's him getting pooped on by Picard in real life, dude. Will Wheaton tweets, I'm officially over people saying, shut up, Wesley, to me, even in jest. From now on, I'm insta-blocking anyone who does that. And Patrick Stewart said, shut up, Will.
Oh, shit. Yeah, give him three more.
That's so beautiful.
That's
dude.
A fuck-owning.
Where do I even put that? I guess I'll just put it...
Yeah, put it in his social media shit.
Yeah,
add it to that total.
Being that... Dude, being destroyed that hard. I mean, just...
Oh my God! The best response from the only person that could have done it, coming from him just makes it ever the more stinging.
Here's WillWheaton.net, dude. My name is Will Wheaton. I live.
So this is where are they now? Depression.
I live with chronic depression, and I'm not ashamed.
One of these, huh?
Look at him through some fucking like bamboo or something. It's like. Will Wheaton in his backyard in L.A.
I'm saying,
the grass is supposed to represent the depression that blocks my thoughts.
Yeah. So, can you read this in a really whiny voice?
Let me just find some fucking, like, sad music or something.
Yeah, dude.
You know what? I don't have
some pathetically sad music.
I don't even.
All right. Well, whatever.
Whatever. It'll probably just get the stream flagged anyway. Before I begin, I want to warn you that this talk touches many triggering subjects, including self-harm and suicide. I also want you to know I'm speaking from my personal experience. And that if you or someone you know may be living with mental illness... Please talk to a licensed or qualified medical professional. Because I'm not a doctor. My mom was on Star Trek, though. Okay.
She played one on TV.
Let's do this. Hi. I'm Will Wheaton.
Hey.
I'm 45 years old. I have a wonderful wife. Two adult children who make me proud every day. And a daughter-in-law who I love. Like she's my own child. I work... on the most popular comedy series in the world.
What is that again?
I don't know.
The Big Bang Theory.
Oh.
I've been in New York Times.
I'm a bit player on a TV show.
Listen to this highlight. I've been a New York Times number one best-selling audiobook narrator. Wow. What a fucking achievement.
What a shit thing to brag about.
I have run out of space in my office for the awards I've received for my work.
Your office must be the size of a broom closet. I don't even
know. Yeah, is it the same closet where they made Harry Potter live?
Is your office a Nike shoebox under your bed?
And as a white, heterosexual, cisgender man in America, I live life on the lowest difficulty setting with the celebrity cheat enabled.
Well, that's a lie.
My life is, by every objective measure... This sounds like humble bragging bullshit
it
to
is,
me,
dude.
Oh, it is.
That's a total
This is
theme.
Not about depression. This is about him bragging about his fucking
dude,
film
let
resume.
Let me tell you something about this dude. This is such a fucking total scam for attention. That's all it is.
You know, people think just because I'm attractive, rich, famous, and showered with praise everywhere I go that I should be happy, but I'm not. Because I'm too deep.
You know, my wife says my dick is too big to even fit. But you know, hey, we've all got problems, right?
Oh, my God. He gets 20 points for... No, not 20. 10 points for this alone.
Wait till we get to his vlog,
I mean,
dude.
I think your first instinct was right.
20?
You know what, dude? I really hate it when people, like... depression's
yeah,
not
it, 20.
Funny.
20.
I wouldn't make fun of him just for having depression, but this exploitative nonsense...
This is self-aggrandizement
like, yeah,
in the form
I'm gonna do
of
the,
pretending to be depression.
I'm going to do the popular I have depression and I'm not ashamed post just as a way to plug all the fucking things you're doing. Fuck you. 20.
So here's another blog post from this fucking
his Twitter retard. Crusade.
Where was this from? What day? Does it say the date somewhere? Bottom,
this
top,
is pretty whatever. Recent.
All right, so it's recent. That's all we know.
Jesus, what a day. Apparently a couple of exceptionally popular YouTube creators were talking on Twitter about being blocked by me. Their fans grabbed their jump to conclusion mats, torches and pitchforks in hand, and went on a rampage through my mentions. So I guess it's time for the obligatory blog post that I don't want to write but need to write about how I use social media. First off, I think I know what happened in this case. A couple months, or maybe it was weeks, in 2018, hours can feel like days ago. Wow, the digression just totally destroys the flow of anything you were saying there. A toxic YouTube personality with a large and unsurprisingly toxic following just went after me one day without provocation. Over the years, people have tried to create the illusion of a feud with me in an effort to get my attention and grab some free publicity to drive up views. No one's fucking looking at you to drive up views,
bitch. I know, dude. It's so laughable.
It's like, well, I'm going to ride the coat. This is the same as bullshit.
They're shitting on you for sucking, the
same
dude.
MO.
Guys, stop the presses. Not enough people are watching us. You know what we need? Will Wheaton.
Will fucking Wheaton.
Hey, dude, we're trying right now.
Yeah, that's right. We are sucking on the teeth of Will Wheaton.
Another 10 points for this other self-aggrandizing post.
I'll go read some of his, like, rules for Twitter, dude.
His rules for Twitter?
Yeah, like, go
rules.
Down.
His Twitter rules.
Oh, right. These are
is
his
this
rules?
Them?
Yeah, dude.
All right, so these are the Twitter rules. I actually use Twitter and other platforms the way people use them. I'm not a hashtag brand who doesn't care. I'm a real person who really looks at my mentions and stuff. I've said it before. If you cut me, I will bleed. Promises, wow. Promises, faggot. Nobody is entitled to my time and attention. Yes, I block thousands of people on Twitter because it's bad for me on Twitter. Yes, I block people I've never talked to and never will talk to. Usually that's because they've announced to the world that they're garbage by following a garbage account that trolls and bullies and attacks people. Wow. Chris Hardwick gave... Oh, I don't know if you want to be tossing that name around, buddy. He's a raper. Chris Hardwick gave me great advice. I'm going to paraphrase here. He said, when you're interacting with a person, you should rape them. No. Your first reaction is go fuck yourself. Think about all the times you want to unleash hell on someone. But 3 or 4 or 7 messages later, you could talk like people and move on with your lives. Hardwick said, whatever, I don't give a shit what Hardwick says. When Twitter treats abuse as a serious, systemic, societal issue with real consequences and not a public relations challenge, all of this will change.
So basically, he wants Twitter to become a draconian lockdown platform.
Yeah, I stand by my 10 for this article.
That just bans any sort of joking or any quote-unquote harassment.
No, harassment. What is this?
This is his music.
His music?
No.
Oh, yes, dude.
All right, we can only listen to a small bit. I know you're disappointed.
What?
Does he sing?
No. Not that I'm aware of.
It's just like shit electronica.
Yeah, he just makes generic electronica music.
Garbage. All right, so another 10 for his bullshit music.
10 more for sucking.
And what is this? Oh, that's nothing to do with him.
And I thought the perfect thing to end on was yet another stream of self-consciousness. This is actually one of his most recent YouTube, or maybe even his most recent YouTube
video. This is his most recent YouTube video?
Wow.
It's very telling.
So this is a look into the mind of Wes.
Yeah.
Timely.
All right.
I think Will Wheaton thinks life's been a little unfair to him lately.
Yesterday that I'm sure to, like, most of you watching this, you're going to be like, duh, I can't
believe
see
the video.
You're 45 and you're just figuring this out. But I keep a private journal for myself. It's like an outgrowth of when I was first starting to write in my blog, when I was like keeping a very public diary about like things that went well and things that didn't go well and hopes and fears and all that stuff. And I'm at a point in my life now where the people in it don't deserve to be like thrust into the public just because they happen to be characters in my story. So I keep this journal for myself, and I write about what's going on. And
you'll never read it. It's my super secret journal.
I have a secret diary where I talk about all the girls that I have a crush on, and you'll never get to read it. It's secret and just for me.
Oh, God.
It's so just for me that I'm going to talk all about it.
It gets better. Keep listening.
about, like, she's like, so what are you doing this year? What's going on with you? And I started to list all the things that I'm working on, right? The things that I work on for myself. Because if there's a thing that I have figured out in the last, gosh, like 10 or 15 years, it's that, like, if I sit back and wait for someone to hire me to do the work that I want to do.
I want to punch his fucking face.
He is give him one just for the punchability.
Another
again.
Punchability.
Something about the last 10 or 15 years, people just don't want to hire me for some reason.
All right, I'll remember to add it later.
It's never gonna work. That's just I'm just not a person that like the entertainment industry is like. Oh man, we can't wait to work with you. It's weird.
No shit.
It's not weird.
Why is
it's
weird?
It's not weird at all. You're horrible. Pony. You're horrible, and you suck.
You should be happy you had your fucking 15 minutes, dude. That's a 15 minutes more than pretty much 99.9% of
go
people
go pull another get. Leech off your dick.
And as because I mention this almost every time I do one of these things, clearly, like, you know, it's a thing that kind of bothers me. But I'm reaching a point in my life and in my career where, like, you know, maybe being on camera is just not the way it's going to be, and I've talked about that too. But what I do really love doing is writing and storytelling.
God.
Dude, it's just him. It's basically him whining.
What I really love doing is writing and story.
Yeah, I never actually wanted to be a famous actor.
I'm such a brilliant writer that it's almost a shame to waste my talent on the screen.
I mean, the reason why everybody always
doesn't
poops.
Even get me anyway, you guys.
Yeah, the reason that everybody always poops on my acting is because that's never what I really wanted to be. My heart's really in
I'm
writing.
I'm a storyteller.
And storytelling, where my accolades are just so many that I can't mention, of course. Especially my secret diary that none of you can read.
Don't read it.
Yeah, my secret fucking diary. Look, I'm such a successful author, too. Look.
Look.
Wow.
Those
look
spikes
at my...
right there indicate the two books that I sold.
Wow, it's amazing, you guys. You see all the books I sold?
I'd say five for this plus one for punchability, six total.
I think that's fair. All right. Fair enough.
Like everything he does is so pompous and just like
self-aggrandizing,
hey
humble bragging.
It's me, shit. Will Wheaton, and you know I really hate to do this type of stuff, but I just wanted to talk a little bit about like my process of creation and stuff. And I'm pretty humble about this stuff. Usually don't talk about it, but I thought it would be interesting for you to see how like a creative, brilliant mind works.
It's so transparent.
God,
dude.
He sucks so bad. I mean, I just, the fucking ridiculous levels of self-aggrandizing fucking bullshit.
It's like, I have depression. I've been in The Big Bang Theory, which is, by the way, the best show in the world. And I've been on Star Trek. And of course, Stand By Me and so many movies I've personally forgotten. Like, where's the depression, dipshit? Nope, just wanted to brag about all the things he's done. Because he gets a lot of shit on Twitter about being a fucking asshole and a loser.
All right, so the competition
has drawn to a close. Unless we want to assess any last minute, do we think anybody...
All right, so hold on. I'm not going to tell you the fucking final scores here.
Yeah, because it's close, I'm sure.
But just in your minds, think about Chris Kattan. Think about Ned Carlos Mencia. And think about Will Wheaton. Mm-hmm. And ask yourself, do any of them deserve more points just for the beings that they are?
I got to be honest with you. I mean, I don't know if this counts, but I felt like a couple of times while we were watching Will Wheaton stuff and looking at stuff that I wanted to say punchability point, but I didn't because I didn't want to be all repetitive. But I think there was at least a couple of times that he deserved another.
I think Will Wheaton needs at least 5 more points for punchability.
So 5 points.
Yeah, I mean, I was going to go 2, but like, yeah, it was probably at least 5 that I missed. You know what I mean? Like, he's just, every time you see him, the first thing that goes through my mind, at least, is punch. Yeah, I just have
knock his fucking block off,
this
dude.
This primal rage builds up in me, and I just want to smash his face with my fist. So, 5 more punchability points for Wheaton. Kattan, is there anything? I mean, I honestly feel like he might deserve 5 more points just for being him. Just in a general sense, because he's Chris Kattan, and you guys want some cookies and shit.
You know, give him 5 more.
Done.
What about Mencia?
You know what he gets it for? He gets 5 more points because he's a goddamn fucking huckster.
Okay.
He hasn't done anything original.
Yeah, I'm fine with that.
And he's just
and
fucking,
he admits it too.
And he's bland. And you know what? He denied it. Then he went to like, yeah, man, I fucking stole.
He tried to do this like thing that's it's cool to own it. So I'm just gonna be like, yeah, I steal whatever. And it blew up in his face. Yeah, five more for
and
that.
And now he's just riding the same bullshit into
with
the ground.
The addition of the
I mean, we didn't really change anything with that. Everybody got five points.
We just gave another 5 points.
But
to everybody.
I guess, you know, whatever, it's fair. They
but
needed it.
The final score with five extra points added to everyone just for good measure. Chris Kattan, 86 points. 86 Biebers.
It's like approaching 100 Biebers.
Carlos Mencia.
A.K.A. Menstelia, a.k.a. Ned Holness.
58 Biebers.
Wow, so he's definitely not winning this. Still a little bitch, though.
Oh, yeah. Not as big a bitch as Chris Kattan. Will Wheaton, 114 Biebers.
Wow.
Damn!
I knew it was going to be high. I didn't think it was going to be that high.
The fucking king of the fucking little bitch, dude.
Oh, my God. And you know what? Really, he does deserve this.
God, it's a runaway.
As bad as Chris Kattan was, he was just doing the only thing he knew how to do, which was, you know, act like a gay guy. But Will Wheaton knows what he's doing, and he's smug and shitty.
Dude, I don't think we've ever assessed that.
We have never had a score like this before.
This is oh, wow. You know what? Let's mark this occasion and just tell people. If you haven't watched our list before, if you happen to be new, if you missed those for whatever reason, or you're not a patron and you missed some of the patrons-only ones, this is the single highest assessment that we have ever given in the history of rating has-beens and cringe lords.
I mean,
and shit.
Maybe it's not if I'm wrong, but it's the high. I think it is.
I mean,
sure
I can't remember. I don't know. I don't know if we can find someone that could be rated in Whedon's. I don't honestly.
I mean,
know.
I know Coolman. You know, if he was still up and around, would go check for us. Maybe somebody will verify. But I'm pretty sure that this is the highest assessment that we've given, and well deserved too. Honestly. I don't feel like we were harsh on Will Wheaton. I don't feel like we gave him more points than he earned.
I felt like we were pretty much honest about what our assessment of him as a person was. God, I don't think we had to go out of our way to be mean to him. It's just like...
He's just a reprehensible, unlovable, unlikable, unwatchable piece of shit human being.
God, he's so
and the worst thing is, and the worst thing is he bills himself as the exact opposite. Like, I'm a really good guy, I'm really nice, and I'm really caring. It's like, no, you're fucking not, dude. You're someone that brags about every little minor fucking goddamn achievement you've had in your life.
I have so many awards.
It's nakedly because he feels insecure because people give him shit because he sucked and stuff. You know what I mean? It's like he feels the need to bring it up constantly because he thinks that counteracts or somehow endears him to people like us who look at most of what he's done and go like, man, this is shit.
Like he talks about all these panic attacks. I'm like, you know why you have these panic attacks if you actually indeed do have them? It's because you won't confront reality.
Yeah,
a lot of people don't like you, and they think you're a fucking piece of shit. That's fine. You know, that's reality. Who cares? Just accept that a lot of people don't like you and move on with your fucking life instead of denying them and blocking them and doing everything in your power not to hear the fucking truth about yourself.
I mean, there's a good chance with this asshole that those panic attacks are just another segue for him to shill his books.
Pay attention.
Talk about his awards and shit.
Pay attention to me. It's like, no one's going to pay attention to you, dude. You had a fucking character on a fucking popular TV show 20-plus years ago.
I need a cigarette. I'll be back.
Move on with your fucking life.
Yeah. I mean, all three of these dudes were so sad, though.
They really are.
I mean, this little bitch competition, when we conceived of it, I knew that it was going to be good, you know, because we were putting three dudes head-to-head that were all little bitches, and I had no idea how it was going to come out in the wash. We never do. I mean, it's not until we get the final count that you really know who's going to pull out ahead of these.
I'm not surprised, though.
But I'm really not shocked by how this one turned out. I really thought it was going to be either Kattan or Wheaton. When I was pulling Kattan, I'll be honest with you, I really thought it was going to be Kattan because I was just like, man, everything I found was just worse.
I thought that initially, but the reason I actually volunteered to do Wheaton was because I suspected he was going to be like this, and like he did not disappoint.
Oh, man, much worse than I thought
it
was going to be.
Dude, it was
I knew
like,
he was a reprehensible fucking piece of shit.
It was like 3 hours of like looking into his life, and I'm just like, God, it's like, I've never met someone that brags so much but is such a void of a human being. Like, he's so unoriginal. He has nothing to say. He's just derivative, generic, fucking Hollywood trash, dude.
Well, that's
and he's
him.
Fucking just a fart sniffer that fucking is getting high off his own bullshit.
A self-fart sniffer, yeah. Too.
Ooh, oh, that was a good one.
I mean, it's one thing to sniff another person's farts, but like to get it high on the your own butt fumes, man. That takes a special kind
of
dude.
I mean, Catan is just a fucking train wreck, typical washed up
comedian. He's kind of a tragic figure, honestly, in comparison to these other guys. He's just, you know, a dude that has no talent, really. They got pigeonholed into, you know, doing gay antics and stuff. And, for you know, if you take him at his word, he's not a gay dude.
You can kind of fucking, yeah, you can have some empathy for him. Like, Carlos Mencia, it's not so much an empathy angle, but, like, there's actually a shred of... He's at least a decent performer in some
Yeah,
in some
I mean,
degree.
At least he's... Like, it didn't help him, but at least he was like, yeah, I steal shit. I mean, whatever. It doesn't redeem it, but at least he had the balls to come out and say it. Whereas Will Wheaton, when has he ever been like...
He has the worst elements of both of these other guys.
When has Will Wheaton ever been like, I was wrong, or backed down from something,
never.
Or admitted that he has a complex that makes him way oversensitive?
Nope.
Yeah, that just isn't in his cards. Like, there's nothing human in him. He's just like a big need machine that'll never get enough fuel. It'll never produce enough of whatever it is that the machine is producing. It just has to run all the time. He needs attention. He needs validation. I mean, that's so obvious. Validation above all things.
Oh, God, yeah, dude.
What drives the engine in the brain of Will Wheaton is, like, this constant need for people outside of him that don't know him
to
go,
I like you. You're good.
I like you. You're a nerd icon. You're a Star Trek staple. You know, he needs to hear this from people, even though none of it's true. He's not a fucking nerd icon because he sucked on the... Because he was the worst thing on The Next Generation. He's a nerd icon.
No, I'm a nerd icon. Guys, remember me for that TV show?
Because he fucking... Like,
the one that they fired you from?
Because he habitually goes to every fucking Comic-Con hoping that people will recognize him. That makes him a nerd icon. Fuck.
Dude, I was hoping... This is a personal anecdote. I was hoping, like, beyond hope, just whatever fucking, you know, optimist there was left in me.
Yeah.
Was like, when I was going to the Star Trek convention in 2015 or whatever it was, I was like, if there's a god, please let Will Wheaton be there so I can fucking make fun of him. I remember, like, TD was like, dude, you're gonna get fucking kicked out or something if you do that. I'm like, I don't give a shit, dude.
It'd be worth it.